Ladies and gentlemen, Natural Chats is back. First off, I want to apologize for the hiatus. There's been moving house, new job, hell, even setting up what I'm going to be calling the new studio. Just want to put a bit of a disclaimer on this. Me and Wombat do sort of go down into a bit of a dark tunnel, as you'll say, with some of the army stuff. He brings up some colorful things that he saw. So just a bit of disclaimer that there will be some things that may trigger some things for some people. But other than that, it was a fun conversation about his army, our time as a tag team, his wrestling career as a whole, and even some personal life with the man behind the mask of Wombat. Hope you enjoy. Gentlemen, welcome to Natural Chats, wrestling chat with my guest, Combat Wombat. How you doing?
G'day, good.
How's life going?
Yeah, not too bad.
Yeah?
Considering we're in a pandemic, I'm doing all right.
How have you been with the pandemic?
Look, to be honest, at the start, we didn't do much wrestling, did we? But I was supposed to be retired, and all of a sudden, last year, I did about, felt like 10 matches.
Yeah, you did a few. And I did a few for Wide Bay. Nightfall. Did you go to Rocky as well?
No, I did Gladstone. We went to Gladstone.
It was Gladstone.
Yeah.
That's what it was. And how was that?
Yeah, it was really good considering I remember going there back in the old days when I used to play football. It was a small little town. And I didn't really think the whole pop festival thing would take off.
Yep.
But it was huge up there, so it was really good. My nephews got to see me wrestle, which was great.
Have they seen you wrestle before?
They have in Rocky a couple of years ago, yeah.
Okay. So that was obviously for QWA up at in Rocky?
Yeah, that one was.
Yeah, and then Gladstone was obviously Wide Bay.
Yeah, that Wide Bay guys did the Gladstone one.
Yeah.
And so they saw a different mix of wrestlers. And so that was, it was really good. And we had, because it was a pop, the pop festival, they had Spider-Man and Batman.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was interesting. Wrestling Spider-Man. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah, I think the people who know my opinion on that one, yeah, they know it. Obviously, we've done shit like that together. Obviously, a Supernova. Man, we had some good times at Supernova, didn't we?
Yeah. That was the one I got spat on at the Gold Coast, wasn't it?
Yes. Poor Rich Rozelle.
Yeah. Yep, and he actually apologised to me end of last year.
And there you go. Actually, it was just poor bad timing for him.
It was a bit.
Because we went for our first interstate trip to Sydney against SMS, which is Unsocial Jordan and Snapchat, now known as Tyler Payne. And they basically said to you, like, if we get in your face or do anything, try and come in. Like, give us a reason to cheat. So, poor Reese ate the backlash of that one.
Yeah. I gave him a good hit.
Yeah. A very shoot hit. And then continued to beat the fuck out of him. Yeah. Oh, that poor guy.
He was the only one either, because someone, I think Spaceman hit someone as well, didn't he?
Yeah, Spaceman, he slapped the shit out of Bushido.
Oh, it was a good time.
Came in too early.
Yeah, all we needed was a couple of rums and it would have been a good night.
I mean, yeah. Because I think we had to travel around to the Gold Coast for that one, didn't we? That was Gold Coast, not Brisbane.
Sorry, what was it?
That was Gold Coast, not Brisbane. Pretty sure it was.
Yeah, that was Gold Coast. Yeah.
Yeah. So that was pretty full on.
Yeah, that was all at the Gold Coast one, that one. And we've done a couple. Have I done with you here in Brisbane? I've done a lot of different Brisbanes.
I feel like we would have. Yeah, I feel like we did. Yeah, we've done a lot of shit together.
We did one at a football match where they had, not a football match, it was like for the football, for their boxing night. Do you remember that? I was your manager and it was raining. Do you remember that?
At a football match?
It wasn't a football match, it was at the rugby league club and it was for their boxing night.
Oh, is that when we did the Fatal 4-Way Hardcore?
Yeah, probably. I was the manager.
I forgot you were there. Yeah, because I think it was me, Kelso Cojones, Mitch McCarthy, which I think he tied in with them, and Jesse Daniels.
Yeah, Jesse Daniels.
Yeah, yeah. Fuck, that was actually fun. That was a fun time too.
Yeah, it was funny watching the boxers on a wrestling mat. That was really good.
Especially because it was a vinyl one. They were slipping a lot. And these weren't like pro boxers. It was like a charity thing. And it was just
It was all rugby players.
Yeah, it's just all the teams. Yeah.
And I don't think any of them have boxed before. Maybe some had, but they were on this wrestling mat, and yeah, it was a little bit.
They enjoyed it.
It was raining too, and it was outside.
Yeah, it started to drizzle. I don't think it was too bad though. And then they fucking gave like a whole carton of Canadian Club or whatever else.
Yeah.
Afterwards, like, oh, here's some beers, mad shows, dope. And I'm like, oh, Canadian Club, okay. It wasn't actually bad. It was my first time I had it. It wasn't that bad.
Yeah.
Far out. So let's get to know the person behind the mask.
Yep.
I like to ask, how was your upbringing? Because obviously you were a country boy.
Yeah.
So how was that?
Yeah, it was pretty good, I think. It's sort of, I didn't know anything else, really. So my dad, he was from a small country town in Victoria called Charlton.
Yep.
And my mum also was from the same town, and they hated each other, and they were the same age, same class, and didn't like each other very much. Eventually, as they got older, that changed, as opposites attract, apparently.
Yeah.
And they moved to Bendigo, got married, and had me.
Oh. Yep.
And I had three other sisters.
So you're the oldest?
Yeah, I'm the oldest, yeah. I experienced all the shit first. Yeah.
So at what point did they move up north?
So I was 10. Dad was landscaping at Bendigo, and back in the 80s, Gold Coast was sort of a good beacon for Victorian workers.
Okay.
So, life's a bit better and up here. And so Dad sort of joined the migration and moved up. And we moved at a place, it's called Willow Vale, but it's basically Pimpama. A little bit different.
Okay.
So people go, well, that's not country, but back when I was a kid, it was.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. There was, to get your groceries and stuff, you had to drive to Beenleigh.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Dude, that's a bit of a distance.
Yeah, now they've got a shopping centre there. But
yeah,
when I was a kid, it was all farmers and graziers and a lot of Victorians, New South Wales people just pretending to be farmers, basically. Yeah,
right.
Our school only had 50 kids in it when I first got there.
I'm trying to get it right in front of you. If you need to pull it out a bit, to pull it out a bit.
Yep.
Yeah. Yep. Want it dead in the middle.
Yep.
Oh, that's better.
Yeah, so they had 50 kids when I was there, and by the end it was about 100 when I left, and I went to a high school in Helensvale, which is also the school that Tony Storm went to.
Oh.
Yeah.
I'm assuming not at the same time.
No, I'm a little bit older. Yeah. Yeah, but didn't really enjoy my time there, but I don't think I really liked high school anyway, so I don't think it would have mattered where I went, and so I got picked on a fair bit.
Did you not like school in general, or just
I liked primary school. I liked learning, but I got picked on a little bit, and it started to, things sort of go downhill from there, you know. And then you start to get scared of school and can't wait for holidays. And I still had friends though, which I know some kids unfortunately didn't. So I was lucky that way. I still had a lot of friends, but I still copped it a fair bit.
Okay. So how was it leaving school then?
Leaving school was great, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So what did you end up doing?
So when I first left, the graduation, we had to hurry back. So I actually went to Rockhampton for the last 4 years of my school life. And my graduation, once I got the rewards at year past year 12, and I said thanks, then I went home, got packed quick, and then I was on a plane sent up to Townsville for reserve training, Army reserve training.
Jeez, straight into it.
Straight into it. And I remember I got off the plane and the sergeant was standing and he says, right, your fucking wife is mine now. And I went, oh, what have I done? Yeah, I thought, this is the dumbest thing I've ever done in my life. Yeah.
It's funny. The first time we met, It was at New Globe.
Yep.
And I got told to be there at a certain time to set up the ring.
Yeah.
I was there like an hour and a half early, apparently. And the first person who walks in, I'd seen you at the Overdrive show that was on Foxtel. But I didn't know it was you.
Yeah.
Without the mask, not a clue. And you're like, hey, you know, this is my shoot name. I'm like, oh, hi. You're like, oh, I'm Combat Wombat. I'm like, oh, okay.
Yeah. I get that a lot, actually. Yeah.
And then the first question you asked me is, oh, yeah, how old are you? I think at the time I was 15. Yeah. You're like, oh, what year were you born then? You're like, 99. Oh, mate, I was off in East Timor fighting the militia in 99.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. And I was sort of thinking about, oh, God, kids were born then. I didn't even know that. I had a lot of other things on my mind. Yeah.
So, from the reserves, so obviously, how was the training? Then, how was the progression?
Yeah, so it was a bit different. So, actually, in Rockhampton, I was actually a Navy cadet to start with.
Yeah, right.
So, at high school. So, I did Navy cadets. And I was going to join the Navy and be a cook because that's all I thought I could do. Like I said, I got picked on a bit of weight, liked food. That sounds all right.
So, knew how to cook.
Yeah, well, I was better at eating it. But and I met one of my best mates. He's a baker, still a good friend of mine. He's in Tassie, but we sort of become friends in year 10, I think, in home ec cooking.
Okay.
And I had this idea that I was going to be a cook because I wasn't very good at sport. Loved it. Loved watching AFL, which wasn't a great thing in Rocky because...
Probably not.
Rugby league. It's rugby league or bull riding or you're... faggot, basically. Yeah, and back in the 90s, you could say that. I mean, you can't say that these days because...
No, so disclaimer.
No, yeah. So, sorry for offending anyone, but I used to be called that a lot. And I've actually been hit and had things happen to me and been called...
Just because you enjoyed AFL?
Okay. It was a different...
Far out.
It was a different time. Like, if you said... Like, I don't know. I don't mind the colour pink or something like that. Yeah, you're gone.
Oh, man.
It was a tough time. Yeah. You couldn't... Like, really, the only sports was, I think, rugby league and bull riding. That was about it.
And what year was this?
So I got up there 93 and 94.
So it shows you how much it's sort of changed almost 30 years.
It has changed a lot. Yeah. And even when I was first in the army... it was quite, you know, if you were gay, you'd keep your mouth shut.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. And as I sort of went along, slowly people sort of opened up a bit and probably everyone seems to be okay with it now. But back then you kept it shut if you were gay. Yeah,
yeah, right.
Yeah, times have changed. Because I remember when we used to work together at the pet food place and one of the girls there was gay and I was telling her how I used to get called gay and stuff and
that's
all the time. And she said, oh, you should have told him it's a privilege to be gay. And I said, well, this is the 90s, so.
Yeah.
And some of those people that picked on me actually ended up being gay, so.
That actually turned out to be a thing. That's actually, the statistics on that's kind of scary when you think about it.
Yeah.
That's funny. Look, you would have said, oh, it's a privilege to be gay. And they're like, oh, it's a privilege to beat up there, then. Oh, jeez. Again, sorry for the delay. It's a privilege to be beat up then.
Yeah, yeah. So it was...
I'll get used to it, I swear.
But also because I was a Navy cadet, so back then... the whole rumours of all Navy people personnel were gay and
stuff.
Yeah,
was it? Go look at the Golden Rivet.
Yeah, Golden Rivet. Yeah.
Ankle anchors.
Yeah, all that sort of stuff. So, but I saw a really good career. I said, oh, this might be something I could do. And my grandfather... He served in the Navy in World War II, and he also cleaned up Hiroshima, so...
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah.
Far out.
He said there wasn't much there. So.
No, it would have just been dust.
I think, there wasn't any buildings higher than his ankles, I don't think.
Yeah, right. That's just crazy.
Yeah. So I, one of the following footsteps when I realised, and I thought, oh, cooking's an avenue I could probably do, and I was doing okay in cooking, so that was what I aimed for. And I had to try, and because I was a solid kid, I sort of tried to run and sort of get into that sort of stuff. And when I left school and I was in the Army Reserve, I started to play AFL. I didn't play AFL when I was at school because my parents wouldn't really let me. Plus, it was hard because I was doing Navy cadets, and that took up a lot of time.
So is your grandfather the reason you decided to get into it?
The Navy, yeah.
Okay, and then what made you switch from Navy to Army?
Yeah, that's an interesting story. So I went, when I was in year 11, I went to an interview to join the Navy.
Yep.
And they said, you're not what we're looking for. So
right.
I sort of got a bit pissed off with all that. And actually, it was year 12, because then I went to the Rocky show and there was this Army Reserve set up.
Yep.
And I walked in and I told him, I just got knocked back from the Navy and I was a little bit upset about it. And he goes, oh, here, come to this place at this time. And next thing I know, I've joined Army Reserve Infantry.
Yeah, right.
They told me that I had to do the infantry course before I could do cooking course, which was bullshit.
That doesn't make sense.
It didn't, but I was...
He learned how to shoot 18-year-old,
and yeah. Yes. So I ended up joining the Army Reserve as a grunt.
Yep.
At the 42 Royal Queensland Regiment. And so we flew up to Townsville on the day of graduation.
Yep.
And like I said, it got there late at night. We sort of come out of this plane.
Good plane?
It was a caribou. We used to call them flying kangaroos because they used to bounce in the air. Yeah. So the where Qantas probably started from.
Right.
But we got off the plane. A few of us were mucking around, trying to get to know each other because we didn't know any... No one knew each other.
And get comfortable in the situation.
Sorry?
And be comfortable in like the situation that you're in because it's completely new to all of you.
Yeah. And everyone's sort of trying to get to know each other. And then the sergeant says, right, for the next 3 weeks, you fuckers are mine. And I can do whatever I want.
No.
And he did.
Do tell.
It was just a pretty tough training. Like, they'd come in early in the morning, rip all the sheets off, you know, tell them to get out of bed, rip all the sheets off the bed. They'd start banging on, you know, the bins we use in wrestling to smash each other. They had one of those. They used to have a stick and just bash it and things like that. They come in yelling, get the hell up. The thing is, if you had an alarm on and you got up 5 minutes before, they'd say, get fuck back to bed.
Yeah, right.
And then they wait and then it was time, bang, yep, get the fuck out of bed. And this was just reserve. The regs got it a lot harder, which they can tell you. But so the Army Reserve, I was there for about 2.5 years.
Yeah.
When you get back to your unit, it's obviously not like the training. It's a lot more relaxed and you sort of get to know people. And back in, I'm not sure what reserve is like these days, but back then, I'd probably do about 100 days a year.
Far out.
Which is still a fair bit for a reservist. We used to have to put permission in to do extra days. We used to do extra.
Yeah, right.
Work. Yeah.
So what were you doing on the off days then?
Well, I used to work with my father as a landscaper.
Okay.
Because for some family, or we all, some reason, all the males ended up being landscapers at some point.
Okay.
Because all dad's brothers all sort of did that, and all the sons seemed to follow suit. So I ended up doing that, plus the Army Reserve. So it was sort of an okay income.
When you were in the reserves, is that still Townsville?
No, so you do your training in Townsville, and then I went back to my hometown. So I was based there.
Oh, that's all right then.
Yeah.
Didn't have to move them. That's good.
Yeah, so with reserves, it's a bit different, whereas when you regs, they send you wherever they want, wherever you're needed. Yeah.
Okay, so when was your first tour?
Yeah, so I joined in 99. In June, I joined the regular army.
Mm-hmm.
And I got sent to Townsville, to Turara. Now, in those days, they were a bit scared about Timor. They weren't sure what was going to happen. So they grabbed a lot of us reservists and put us straight into the regs. And we had no extra training.
Right.
So they don't do that anymore.
So you're flying in blind a bit.
Yeah, so they don't do that anymore because it failed badly. And there's a lot of us had a few problems, myself included. It was very tough for the first 3 months when I was in the regular army. Quite picked on a fair bit and stuff like that.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Is that purely because you didn't have that extra training?
I think in the minds of a lot of others, yes. Okay. Plus, you have a lot of pressure on yourself. Sometimes you don't think you're good enough. And I was 21. I still didn't really connect real well with other people and stuff. But after I got initiated, things started to change a little bit. When I mean initiated, I got grabbed, zip-tied, sandbag over my head, got with another guy. We got chucked on a couch, got our knees put up and a beer between our knees, a straw. We had to drink it, and they put a carpet snake around our neck. And then after we drank a couple of bottles of beer with a straw, which makes you a bit more pissed, if I don't know if you've tried it.
I haven't, but
no.
All
right. And they stand you up, and they spin you around probably about 10 to 20 times and down the hallway, and they make you run. And you smack into every doorway running down. And
fucking hell.
Yeah, then they spray-painted our hair blue, chucked us in a panel van, and drove us out to a pub, and we sort of just drank from there on. But at first, it was a bit weird. I was a bit terrified, to be honest. Yeah. All these guys come up with balaclavas on, all dressed in black, and tackled me and zip tied me and chucked a carpet snake around my neck. Yeah, it was a bit weird. And for some reason, I ended up having another one where guys made me scull a bottle of wine.
Right.
And I won that competition. It was really good. And I can't remember much after. After that, I ended up taking all me uniform. It was like we had to do this dining in night for officers. So you had to dress up in all your good polyesters.
Yep.
Army outfit. And uniform. I shouldn't call it an outfit. God, I'd be in trouble. uniform. And so the police. So, and I was drinking with that on after we had it. The padre of all people decided to give us heaps of alcohol.
Lovely.
Because he's a good bloke.
Mm.
And we all got pretty pissed, and a couple of guys said, you new guys have got to have a race and skull this bottle of wine. And one guy vomited all over the place. I actually did really well. Went back to my room, and then I changed into going out clothes because I was going to hit it. I was pretty revved up. And then I remember waking up sort of with my head over a toilet bowl, and two other army guys that from my unit, from my platoon, were laughing at me as I was just vomiting because I didn't think, oh, this guy never goes out.
Yeah.
And then I was just vomiting everywhere, and the guys they stripped me off, chucked me in the bed, put the fan on, put one of those rubbish bins underneath near my bed so I could vomit into it.
Yeah.
And they left the door open so they could check on me. And then they went out and got pissed. And
I mean, that's good of them.
Yeah, everyone coming home made sure I was all right. So after that, things started to change. And because I hit the town a bit with them, it's
what's that, the camaraderie?
Yeah. I don't know. I don't think they do as much as that anymore. I'm not sure how they do the whole thing. We had a big drinking culture. And it's good points, but there's a few bad ones about us. There's a few of us drink a bit too much.
So, when you're in the regs, what was an average day? From wake up to going back to bed.
Yeah, so you don't start work till about 7, but you've got to get up at 6. We have to clean our lines. So, where we lived, it was like an old dorm. I think it was built in the 60s or 70s. So, the sort of doors were side by side.
Mm-hmm.
And we all had different jobs. Someone would have to mop the hallway. Others would do the toilets, the showers. We sort of work as together. Then the corporals would come in, make sure it's all clean. Then you'd have a roll. Then you'd go down. That was at 7 o'clock. Then you'd do PT for about an hour. Then you'd have breakfast after you've showered. And
what was the average breakfast?
There was pretty... In the army, in the infantry units, it was bacon and eggs. Yeah.
Yeah, that was it.
Yeah, you had... They had little pancakes and things. Yeah, they did. It was pretty good, really. The cooks did a pretty good job.
Yeah. So then breaky, and then what?
Yep. So after that, it's sort of hard to explain because it depends what you... So don't, sometimes you do cleaning weapons, non-techs, things like that. Sometimes you'd have lessons on different things. And as the build up to Timor, it got more and more, and all of a sudden they're pushing all these sort of things into us. Like the last 2 weeks before we went, we didn't really know if we're going to go or not. This is the thing. People don't realise. It's a bit different to these days where they sort of have training before they go on deployments, stuff like that. We didn't really. We just locked down 2 weeks before. No one was allowed out. No one was allowed in.
Yeah, right.
Except for like things like food and stuff like that. And to get pizzas and things, we could on weekend, but we had to order them. They'd have to drop them off at the guard box. So we'd have to walk down because the pizza guy wasn't allowed in.
Yeah. So
everything was just locked down.
Yeah. At what point did you know, fuck, we've got to get on a plane?
Well, we sort of knew something was going to all these lessons and stuff like that. But sometimes there's guys that went to the airport to get on the plane a couple of years ago and then just got told to turn around and come back. So you didn't really know are they just playing us, or are they just getting us ready, or is this actually going to happen?
Yeah.
Yeah, so when I guess our commanding officer decided to just shout us a whole heap of beer at the boozer, we thought, it's not long now.
Okay. Yeah.
And then we also had the Prime Minister, the opposition leader. I think there was actually two opposition, because it wasn't the Greens, but we had the Democrats then, and we had Labor, and we had...
Liberal,
which was Howard. And they were all there, and they had all these, like, their security and everything with their little pissy little guns, and we're all got Stiers and machine guns and things. Just, why'd you bother?
Yeah.
He's got that many of us around. He's not going to get attacked. But, yeah, we knew then that something's going on because they sort of talked to us all. And
so how's that conversation with them?
Sort of more like they're just trying to keep you in good spirits, and what you're doing is a great thing, you know, helping people from another country. And they all agree on the same outcome and stuff like that.
So what was the goal of it?
Of East Timor or the...
Yeah.
Yeah, so you don't know much about it?
No, not really, no.
So in 75... so it was a Portuguese colony.
Yep.
And in 75, they pulled out. They said, okay, you've got your own independence. And Timor was cheering, pretty happy about that. And then the Indonesians come in and occupied it.
Right.
And it's a situation where in 75, because we just come out of Vietnam, Australia didn't really want to get involved.
Yeah, I knew someone in Vietnam. I'm still friends with them, and hopefully have them on because he's got a lot of crazy stories.
Yeah,
And he's currently got Agent Orange pumping through him. So
yeah. So we didn't want to get involved in another Vietnam, and Indonesia walked in. Now there was, I think, five journalists. Most of them Australian. One was English, I think, and maybe a Kiwi. I can't.
Mm-hmm.
But they all got executed.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah.
Okay.
They got executed, and it sort of...
Is that the big thing? Hey, you don't touch a journalist.
Yeah, well... Yeah, it's sort of... Yeah, that's right. And but Australia still didn't go in. It was pretty... It's pretty Wild West. Yeah.
Is that frowned upon or is that a war cry? War crime.
I don't really know. I'd say it'd be...
Okay. Well, it was enough for you guys to go over.
Well, no, this was 75. This all happened in 75.
Okay.
And so I thought you may have heard of these journalists that were killed, but nothing actually happened from it.
Okay.
So those 25 years or whatever it was up to 99, the international community put pressure on East Timor.
Yeah.
On Indonesia about East Timor. They said, look, they should be allowed to vote if they want to be independent or not. And what happened was all these pro-Indonesia militias started to form.
Okay.
And they started to try and scare people into vote for staying with Indonesia.
Right.
Yeah. So it's pretty violent all the way up until, but it got really bad when they were allowed to vote. Indonesia said, yeah, okay, you can vote for your independence, but they had all this pressure from these militias and they were basically killing women and children, priests, nuns.
Yeah, right.
And we sort of got the word that it was an ongoing thing, and then all of a sudden the government said, okay, we've got to... The international put pressure on the Australian government to say, you've got to step in and do something.
So how do they know? How do they know that all that was going on?
Well, obviously, as media gets better and things, and internet was sort of slowly starting to become a thing, and it was sort of... You had UN workers there and stuff like that. So we set the UN in first. Well, UN workers, police, stuff like that, and they were reporting back. And I remember there was footage of it. Seeing on TV, you see footage of people hiding in the mountains and stuff like that.
Yeah, okay.
Yep, and then it started to get really bad, and there was a lot of reports of a lot of people being killed and murdered in the streets, and a lot of violence, I think, had happened the whole time since when Indonesia got in there, but it just got really bad when this voting come around, and they said, look, we're probably going to have to send troops in.
Okay, and then this is all horrible. All right, so now it's the day of. You're flying over there.
Yep.
First off, how are you feeling? Second off, what was the process of it all?
Yeah, so the feel a bit surreal. Really surreal. You see a lot of movies and stuff when they're all getting geared up, and even when you first join the army, there's a lot of guys going, oh, I want to go to war, I want to kill something. You know, they get this.
Get the crazies.
A lot of us are pretty quiet.
Okay.
Pretty quiet, yep. So what they first did, so the day that it was a Sunday, and the PM and all the politicians were there, they come had dinner with us.
Right.
In our mess. And then we sort of... Well, I don't think we were allowed to... We weren't allowed to drink that night. We all got pissed the night before. That's when we sort of knew, oh, something's going on, because he's giving us free beer and stuff like that.
So, how dare he? That bastard.
Something's not adding up. Yeah. And so then we sort of knew we were going. And I remember one of the corporals said to the PM, he said, oh, look... So we're ready to go. So whenever you want to send us, we're ready to go. And the PM said, oh, that's not my decision to make. I thought, oh, whose is it? Because you're about as high up as they go.
Yeah. Well, wouldn't that be his... yeah. Would that not be his call?
Yeah, I think he's just trying to keep us calm. And it was the general that was it, General Cosgrove. I don't know if you've heard of him, but he was the one that took over. He was the one that sent us in. Part of Innofet, and it wasn't just Australians. We had New Zealanders and Gurkhas. Gurkhas are from Nepal.
Oh, right.
Yeah, very, very highly trained. Yeah, very highly trained.
Fair enough.
And so we sort of had an idea something was going to happen, and we get the feeling, okay, we're going to go. And we were told also a couple of days before not to ring our families, don't tell them what's happening.
Really?
Yeah, because they didn't want Indonesians, the press, to know where Let's be honest, it was an invasion force. But like, where we're coming from.
But you couldn't even like tell your family though? Like what? That they're going to know the Indonesians?
No, we said we things like we could be going in the next couple of days. We don't know when. Something's on the move. Something's happening.
As long as we go to
They all got letters from the Defence Force sent out to our families and stuff like that. But the first day we sort of realised when they started to like the three alcohol not ringing families and stuff, we knew something's up, something's going on. And then the PM comes and we have dinner with them. We go, okay, we're probably going to go tonight.
How's that dinner?
I can just remember Big Beasley, the opposition leader. He was a big guy and his plate was just mounted up. Jeez, guys, taking advantage of free food. Yeah, so, and I remember that we're all a bit sort of nervous. I mean, some guys really wanted it, but I think as it got closer, you could start to see the edginess of the nerves. You're a bit like that when you do wrestling and stuff. You're still a bit nervy and stuff like that.
Sort of off topic, but not. Has your dad ever spoken to you about how he felt when he got that letter?
Well, they had an idea something was going on. They didn't, but when I got there, they didn't hear from me for about a week.
Right.
So they didn't really know if I was in country, if I wasn't, if something had happened. Because obviously the media thing's going on. Because I think
a
couple of guys, a guy did die that week.
Oh, wow.
The first week, yeah. And there was a couple of small contacts with the SAS and stuff like that. But people don't know that, so... I think it was a very hard time because my mum always wanted me to join the military, but she never thought we'd go overseas. She thought it was just a good job and I'd get a good trade out of it, something like that. Didn't really think I'd only been in the regs for 3 months. Didn't really think I'd be sent overseas at short notice. But that's why they put a lot of us reservists, pushed us through because they needed the numbers at the time.
Did they ever tell you how they felt?
They were sort of quite nervous and very unsure what was going to happen. And I think it's funny, we're growing up with sisters, they annoy you get really mad at them. But those things sort of change once you go over to a place like that. And all you want to do is go back to them and say you actually do love them and stuff like that. Because it's all well and good now to say, oh, it all worked out. The biggest fear is the unknown.
Yeah.
We didn't know if it was going to be a peacekeeping mission or blow out into a war. We weren't sure how it was going to go.
Yeah.
Because at the brief, I remember them saying, the militia want to kill you. The Falantil, they want to be friends with you and fight with you side by side. The Indonesians, that's up to you to work out because we've got no idea what they want to do.
Fuck.
So we, sort of, there's a lot of unknown in there. Yeah, so that night, also when you're talking about the parents finding out, they also send a letter to your next of kin. I decided just to put my uncle's name down. He had no idea, but I put him down and he gets this letter in the... and they're going, what the hell's going on here? And it's got the Defence Force logo on it and everything and says your next of kin has gone overseas. And they were ringing up my parents, panicking, what's going on? And
yeah, right.
Yeah, so I probably should have let them know that they were my next of kin.
So did you have dinner and then bang straight onto a plane?
No. So we went back to our lines as normal. We had our kit all ready to go. We had our weapons signed out. That's another good way to say, okay, you're going somewhere. Weapons signed out, had our night vision signed out, everything we needed signed out, gas masks.
Was the gun just sitting on the bed?
Oh, we had hang on to it all everywhere we went, but yeah, we'd go.
Right, okay.
Yeah. And so it was a bit weird because usually you put them in a safe at night, but this time we had them with us in our rooms. And then we got bang on the door at 11 o'clock, like 11 o'clock at night. I said, get the hell out of bed. Probably with a couple more F-words thrown in there, but we all grabbed our gear. We marched down like a it was a big long green snake all the way down the stairs. We all marched out to the parade ground. They had these massive tarps laid out and these big, big spotlights. And then these guys would come and put down all this ammunition and then start filling up your magazines.
How many mags did you have on you?
It was 7 for that, yes. Usually you have 5 on exercises, but they wanted us to have 7.
That's still really not a lot when you think
not
about it.
Not if you get stuck somewhere, yeah. No.
Yeah.
And then they usually have one guy would have a bag of rounds for spares and stuff like that. I can't remember how many of the machine gunners had, but the weight of the pack and all the gear, I weighed in at 40 kilos of gear carrying. I was carrying gear. Yeah, I was about 80 kilos. I was 80 kilos. I was carrying 40 kilos. When I come back, I was 65.
Jeez, you lost 15.
Yeah. Probably in the first month, I think, most of it.
All right. So you grab your ammunition.
Yep.
You're off to the airport. Back to bed.
Back to bed. And they woke us up at 3. Then there was all these buses in the parade ground. And a bit like the movie We Were Soldiers, when all the buses come and they all march onto the buses. It was a bit like that. Then we went to the airport. And we sort of just waited for the plane. Then we got pushed onto these planes.
So it was a proper airport? Was it like...
Yeah, well, the Townsville airport, I'm not sure what it's like now. But back then, so the Air Force had one bit. And the civilian part was another bit.
Okay.
So we were right at the other, where the Air Force guys are. And so we had a Hercules this time.
Is that one of those big carrier planes?
Yeah, we've got bigger ones now, but at the time that was the biggest one. And I think most of the armies and air forces in the world had those.
So how many guys were there?
Let me think. So we probably had... 60 each platoon, so a platoon and a half, I think. And then the rest of the company become on the next plane. So they had, for one company, you had 2 planes usually, depending. Because some of them had APCs in them.
Mm-hmm.
So the vehicles that had to come out. So we were the first plane in of the main force. There was obviously special forces and all the hush-hush.
Mm-hmm.
We're not allowed to talk about. But those sort of guys... They told us what to expect, what was going to be there, what they knew anyway. And so...
You're going to be a silly question, but is the plane, like the way you're hooked in, is it like, you've seen the new Suicide Squad when they first come in, is that the same sort of deal?
With those, I'm just trying to think. I don't even think we had seatbelts. I can't remember.
But is that sort
we
of
might have,
look?
Yeah, down it does the back. Look like that a bit, yeah.
Yeah.
But... When you're in like that, we don't have as much room as they do in the movies, so...
Oh, yeah, cars and shit in there.
No, not this... Not the one when we went in. We were all soldier. You sit side by side. You've got your webbing on. You take your pack off, and it's in front of your legs. Your rifle is shoved between your legs. And then you've got a pack that side. The other guy, he's got his pack there, and it goes, like, along there. All the packs are side by side. And then the loadie... Who's the guy, the Air Force dude? He walks across your packs to go check the back and do whatever else.
Yeah, right.
And so he's walking all over, and it was the most quiet trip I ever had. I think it was about 5 hours, most quiet trip I've ever had.
Wouldn't have been too comfy?
No, sucked. But I thought that was probably a better place to be than being on the ground, but it wasn't. You didn't, like I said, the unknown was just a scary thing. You weren't sure what was going to happen.
Yeah, now I'm going to assume it's not like some things where you land and you're straight into action.
Yeah,
you
so
would have been
when
like
we landed,
at a base.
Yeah, so when we landed in the Dili airport and it still had Indonesian soldiers there. And they were, I think, supposed to hand over everything to us. There was a bit of tension there.
Okay. They didn't want you there? They wanted to do it themselves?
Not really, yeah. They had a lot of issues at the time with the militia. They were supposed to be stopping the militia. They said they were going to, but they just sort of let them go and stuff like that because they were pro-Indonesian. So when we landed, the first thing you notice, obviously, because when we got on the plane, it was in the early morning, so it was dark. And so when we landed, it was about 9 o'clock or something, and it was you could feel the heat already as you come out.
Yeah, really?
And you got helmets on. Like I said, it was 40 kilos. I was 40 kilos. Some guys were 50. Gunners were 50.
Mm.
50 kilos. We had the old Vietnam flak jackets. And then we had our packs on, gas masks on our legs. Because we didn't know what was going to happen. So we just loaded up with everything. We had night vision in the backpacks and packs and everything. And so we come off the plane. I remember it coming down. And all the troops going out. And they're all cocking their weapons as they... as they get off, meaning that...
yeah, getting ready.
Getting ready to go, just in case something happened. So we had to fan out around the aircraft. And we had to fan out. And I was one of the last guys to walk off. I had my sergeant behind me.
See, I'm not sure if that'd be more daunting. I'm not sure if it'd be more daunting being the first one off or the last one off.
Like, yeah. Yeah, I know. It's, I think if rounds come flying at us, it would have been a different story.
Mm.
We did have a 50 cal... machine gun pointed at us by the Indonesians, apparently. I didn't notice it, so
fucking
guys
hell.
Told me later that they saw one in that direction pointing at us.
Not what you want to see.
No, and when we come off, I'd never been overseas before.
Right.
So the most I've ever done was from Victoria to Queensland, and I've been to Tassie. Sorry, Tassie.
Very memorable trip.
Yeah, but... We come off, and the first thing I remember that was the heat, because also the fans from the, so the propellers, really my army technology words are just not coming out today. Yeah, and the heat from that sort of hits you, and you all got all this gear on, and you're sweating like anything, and this big bug, I swear it was about that big, it hit me in the head, and for a split second, oh, I've been hit. Oh, no, no, sorry, no, no, it's just a bug. Yeah, that was just a split second. I didn't yell it out, but I just mentally went, oh, what was that? Oh, yeah, it's just a bug. And it was the biggest bug I've ever seen. And I've seen all these Chinese palms, like the old palm trees, Chinese palms down one side. And some, I think it was the terminal of the airport. It was sort of like a... different shape building to what you used to, you know, sort of got that sort of an Asian look to it, what you see in the movies then, anyway. And then you see some Indonesian soldiers and that sort of doing their thing, sort of keeping an eye on us, and sort of we fanned out and we had to kneel. They want us to kneel. They didn't want us to lie because our packs were a bit heavy, but they didn't want us to stand. They want us to kneel. I remember kneeling down and I could just feel the weight on the pack, and I just couldn't handle it anymore, and I flipped up like a turtle. I've gone flat on my back,
and
thought, oh, this is really not where I want to be, and was a bit naughty and used my weapon to push myself up, which you're not allowed to do, but I thought, you know, I got to get up somehow. And I remember pushing myself up, and I see this SAS boat come out of the bush, all geared up, all with their, you know, big beards and their all their cool gear and, you know, chest rigs and stuff like that, whereas we've got the old school webbing, and they've got all the chest rigs and all the scrim, and they're looking pretty cool, and they come out, and this guy's just shaking his head at me, and I think he must have thought, what the hell have they sent us? Like,
yeah.
These young guys got no idea. We all were, you know, fingers sort of ready to go, sort of just outside the trigger guard. We were sort of a little bit nervy, and I've pushed myself up, seen a couple of SAS guys. This one was just shaking his head. And then I swear to this day that I saw the RSM come out of the jungle with full polyesters on. Sort of just, I don't know how he ironed them. He must have done it. They're pretty tough, the SAS. He probably did it with a rock or something. But they're all cleanly shaven, like he was. These men weren't. They were all had big beards like mountain men. But he sort of come out and told us to calm down. Because we're a little bit, he said, everything's fine, nothing's happening much here. And then it was just sit and wait. We sort of, that plane left, did the next one come in, the next lot of troops would come out. And every half an hour, a plane would come in, and we'd sort of fan out, sort of get bigger and bigger and bigger, and our battalion was all there. And then every second plane that would come in was from another country, like we had Thailand, the US.
This was a huge operation. Operation.
Yeah.
Far out. Okay. Sorry, continue.
Yeah, so... and so every half an hour a plane would come in. And I remember I was sitting there. We'd been there for about two and a half hours at this stage, still in our full gear, in a Timorese sun. There's no shade. We started to get a little bit calmer when some of us started to get a bit sore. We started to put our weapons down. And I remember this vehicle come past with full of Indonesian soldiers. It was like an old Toyota ute.
Yep.
All they seem to have is Toyotas over there. And they all sit in the back tray. They don't seem to sit in the passenger seat for some reason. They all sit in the back tray. And they come past. And I remember an Indonesian yelling out English at me and said, "Hey, Aussie." And he grabbed his weapon and went like that at me. And I sort of grabbed mine and sort of, you know, not really hesitant, not sure what to do. So that was a little bit of a scary moment at that time, because I didn't know what was going on. And they're trying to provoke us. They were doing it to a lot of guys. A lot of guys said, "Oh yeah," they had to do it to us as well. Like, "Hey, Aussie."
So you know, they really weren't happy you guys were there, and they wanted to fight them so they could fuck you up.
Oh, they just didn't want us there. Just,
I mean, if they're trying to get you to shoot at them, don't you like that.
Yeah, I think we were all testing our boundaries. Because one guy had seen a painting on a wall with a picture of an Indonesian soldier shooting a kangaroo. Like, really bad drawn one. But that was the message, you know, that they wanted to fight us and stuff. But I don't know how true that was.
Well, like, you guys are there to help. Well, obviously, they're not doing their job properly.
Yeah.
Like, excuse the audio. Yeah, like...
Yeah.
You would think that they'd be a little more okay with you being there.
Yeah, it was. I don't think they liked us sticking our nose in their business. And
well, they clearly weren't sorting their business.
Yeah. So,
and it wasn't just you guys either. So it's like, why they got such a issue with you guys? When, as you said, you got like US, Brits.
Yeah, and Napoleons. I don't know. They probably were copying it as well on the Kiwis and all that.
I mean, Kiwis are part of the Antacs, so they're like, it'd be the same thing regardless, wouldn't it?
Yeah, we actually have different uniforms than that. It was funny because some of the different areas I noticed, and because I had two trips, I come back and went to an area that was mainly New Zealand the first time I went.
Mm-hmm.
And all the Timorese that had learnt English had Kiwi accents.
Ha!
And a lot of the ones in Batagarde, which is where we were in the first trip, a lot of us, Balibo and Batagarde, I noticed a lot of the English speaking had Aussie accents.
Yeah, right. That's funny.
Because it's just the way they learnt their English. It was all the kids, because they used to sell us whiskey. I don't know if I should have mentioned that. But yeah, they were selling us different stuff and blankets and things. But that was the second trip. The first trip, we didn't see many people at all, to be honest. Okay. We've gone to the whole towns where there was no one there. Yeah.
So, you had your first trip. As you said, it wasn't too bad.
Mm. Oh, it was... It probably was worse than the first one. The second one, sorry. It probably was. But I had some things happen in the second one that sort of threw me a bit. But
so, in the first one, everyone's there. You're in your bases.
No, we didn't have bases. No.
Yeah, right.
We just lived the first month, I think, we just marched from village to village and just camped where we could find, and we used to...
Now, how was that?
Yeah, that... I didn't realise it until I'd done my PTSD course lately that was actually playing things on my mind. So you're kicking in doors and breaking in people's houses and cooking food, which you can only do at daytime. You can't cook food at night. You're not allowed to do that at night because you're not allowed to have any light. You can't show any light at night time.
Yeah, that's fair.
Yeah, so we sort of broke into people's houses of that, and it didn't sit well with me. Mind you, most of the houses didn't have roofs. They grabbed all the iron and stuff and just ripped everything, burnt everything out. And I think we usually broke into mansions and things like that. And I remember one place we sort of jumped in. It was some guy's dream. He's sort of building a house. And all this stuff had happened, and we didn't know if he was dead or what, but it was sort of like the house was only half built sort of thing.
Yeah.
It actually did have a bit of a shelter, so we went in there. I remember, you know, there was one or two people around, and we go to the house and say if it had a roof or good sort of position. We'd say, look, we're going to take this in the name of the Commonwealth of Australia, blah, blah, blah. And the guy grabbed his chook and walked. He said, righto, off he's go. And then you see all the neighbours think, why are those soldiers there? And they all pick up and then they all start to leave. And then we think, yeah. Oh, shit, something's going to happen. But never did, but never happened. But
so did you ever run in with the militia on the first trip?
No, it was never in any shootouts or anything. Nothing like that. I know some guys that were. I think there was a shootout on the border with Indonesian soldiers. They had a bit of a... They killed one Indonesian and I think one got shot through the jaw.
Oh.
They shot at the Aussies first and then the Aussies retaliated.
I mean, yeah.
And I was out in the bush somewhere when that happened and you heard about it over the radio and no one really tells you what's going on. You don't know what's going on, so you got all these things going for your mind. Are we going to get hit next or what is going to happen? But it's usually feels worse than what it probably was. But the guys that were in it, I've met some guys that were in it, and yeah, it was pretty hairy, they said at the time.
Okay, so how long was that first tour?
It was 4 months.
Okay.
And then we went back for 6 months.
So what made them want to pull you out?
Sorry, what was it?
What made them want to pull you out?
Oh, that was because we were put in right on the border. So a lot of people probably remember back in 99. You won't remember because you were pulling your pants. But a lot of the people that were watching it probably remember a lot of stuff on TV about Dilly, the concerts at Dilly. Because I think Crocodile Hunter went over there, did something in Dilly. We weren't in Dilly. We didn't see any of that. Okay. We didn't even hear about that till we got back.
Yeah, right.
We were right on the border. So we didn't... We patrolled the border. We patrolled villages. And going back to where you said about seeing militia and stuff like that, didn't see them, but I smelt them. So we went for a patrol.
I feel like you've told me a bit of this, yeah.
Yeah, so we went on a patrol with... Someone come running up and said they seen some militia in the area.
So is your goal, sorry, if someone says that, is your goal to go and finish them? Or have you got to, what's the protocol?
In those days it was to pretty much capture them, yeah. We couldn't really shoot unless we were shot at.
Okay. So it wasn't a DOA situation?
Yeah, so we weren't in a war, but we weren't peacekeeping. We were peacemaking.
Okay.
So what we were doing across the board, we were taking weapons off both sides. Even the freedom fighters, I think they thought we're going to fight with them, that kind of thing. But General Cosgrove had this plan just to disarm everybody and then would work it from there and try and rebuild their own government and everything like that. So... But what we found we were doing is we were taking weapons, machetes off everyone. And we didn't realize over there, machete is their livelihood. Like, I've seen guys dig holes with a machete. And they do everything with a machete. And they build their houses. They cut all the bamboo or trees. I've seen them cut trees with these machetes and things like that. It's pretty amazing. And dig holes with them. And that's how they work. So we started to be a bit more lax with that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So then you come home. How was it? Because it's very different. And did you know you were going to go back?
Well, we knew the job wasn't finished.
Okay.
We knew there was going to be a few more years to go yet. And I think Australia didn't pull out till 2005. And then they had to send troops back in 2006 because it fell apart a little bit again.
Okay.
So we had a funny feeling we probably would go back. We weren't sure when, but it was about, I think, 2000. So we got back in 2000. End of 2001, we went back again.
Okay. So how was that? I don't say time off because I doubt it was time off, but the time in between.
Well, we did get time off when we come back. We got... So if you order... I was only there for 3 months before I joined, so I had no leave saved up. But they automatically gave us, I think, 2 weeks for going over.
Mm-hmm.
And I sort of just went back to my family and stuff like that.
How was that?
pretty good, actually. You probably felt like a bit of a hero, you know. It was a big thing.
Emotional?
Because,
I mean, like...
I guess it was, with see my family and stuff, it was, yeah.
Because obviously there's a lot of unknowns of what could happen with you being there or them.
It definitely was for my parents seeing me again, yeah. And taking me out to the pub they sort of went to a fair bit, because the Great Western in Rockhampton has the bull riding and stuff in the back of the pub and stuff, and that was a place they always went.
Mm-hmm.
And we sort of went there for dinner, meeting people that I used to know and stuff like that. But yeah, it was apparently one of the guys at the bar said, yeah, the parents used to come here a bit and they were a little bit sort of down in the dumps a bit because the whole thing was...
And they don't know what's going on.
No, they don't know at all. I mean, they didn't know the first week, I think one of the guys said, I found a satellite phone and we went and jumped on it and rang our parents and stuff. And I think you had 2 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Someone had a satellite phone, like in the back of an army vehicle, and it sit in the back of that. Because I think the internet and that come in Dili and stuff, but we never saw any of that stuff.
Mm.
The only way we got in contact with our family was by mail, where people actually wrote letters. We actually did that. We wrote letters, and you get packages and things like that, and of food, and because we were on ration packs for the first month, and you're starting to clog up, and you didn't go to the toilet much. And
Jesus. So you're here, you're going back. What's the thought process?
Shit, not again. Yeah, sort of. There's like you wanted to go back, but also you didn't. Yeah, because you knew it was going to be 6 months. It's a lot longer than what 4 was.
Was the thought also like, you didn't want to leave a job not finished?
I definitely felt like that, and sometimes I feel that, and I guess with all the stuff that happened to Afghanistan and that, a lot of soldiers probably feel like that.
And looking back now?
Well, I think East Timor, out of a lot of UN missions and stuff in the world, is one of the most successful. So
okay.
There's a little bit of pride there, even though some things did happen that sort of shape you, but you are who you are, you know. I've been shaped because of those experiences. And eventually getting into wrestling and stuff was probably a way. Once I left the army, I did battle reenacting and also wrestling. And that sort of just sort of kept me still sane.
Was the process much the same flying over there?
No, a little bit different. So when we had like 6 months training, I think 3 months or 6 months.
Better training?
3 months training before going back over. And there was a lot more paperwork to fill out and stuff. We didn't really do that the first time because we didn't know what was... They needed to get us over there. Mm. The second time was a lot more organised. And plus the UN had taken over. See, the Australian Army ran the first trip, even though it was international, but this was the first time that military, we were in charge, Australia, and I don't think it would ever happen again.
How was the Indonesian soldiers when you went back?
Were they...
more or less happy?
They were gone, so they were on the other side of their border.
Okay. Now,
so they weren't... and I think they were just as sick of it as we were, I think, by the time that second trip. The first time when we went, it was a part of Indonesia, and when we left, it became East Timor. So it was a little bit different. They all pulled out while we were over there.
Okay, so when you land, same process as before?
No, completely different. ANSET flew us over. We landed in the airport. They had guards at the air. They had people working at the airport. There was people everywhere around Dili, everything. There was bases were set up this time. There was bases everywhere. Whereas the first time, there was bases eventually come in Dili, but when we were outside of Dili and that, there wasn't many bases or anything. Like I said, we used to go from house to house. We'd camp in villages, just camp outside. I camped in a church at one stage.
Jesus.
And I remember that church, we come in, it was only a section of us, and we patrolled down.
How many people?
Anywhere between 7 and 12, I think.
See, that's really not a lot.
No. We come in, and the whole place was still smoking, still on fire, like it was just simmering. And the church was the only thing standing. And because they're all Catholic over there. I don't know if people realize that. A lot of people, because the Indonesians are Muslim, but the East Timorese are actually Catholic because they come from a Portuguese background.
Yeah.
So a lot of people don't realize that, but they're very Catholic. A lot more than, more religious than what we are over here.
Yeah.
And the church was there, and we said, oh, well, we'll camp in there. So I remember we camped in there, and we had guard duty. Two of you to be on guard duty, and everyone else sleeps. You have about, I don't know, a couple of hours, and then you go wake someone else up, and then they do it. And I remember looking in my night vision, and the guy on the guard said to me, have a look up there. And I turned around with the night vision on, and I could see all these eyes staring at me. They're all big rats. They were about that big.
Fuck! Yeah. Just a comparison there for people on Spotify. Probably like a footy.
Yeah. 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 Fuck. And then the tail was added on.
Another footy. Yeah.
Yeah. And they just glared, all looking at you. And I remember one of the guys says, oh, that's it. I'm going to sleep on one of the benches. And I said, dude, if they're up there, they're going to get you on the bench.
Yeah.
And I did have one night when we were.
Sorry. Cheeky bird.
Yeah. We were camped in an old hotel.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a rat jump on my head. It bounced off my head and ran off. And we had problems with that eat through your packs and that eat your rations.
Oh.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So we had issues.
Did you end up shooting rats?
Oh, we never did, but I'm sure someone would have had a crack at it.
I guess, you know, or something. Probably a waste of that.
Like, I know a guy got attacked by a dog and he shot it and he nearly got in a lot of trouble over it. Because dogs have rabies over there too. So. And like a lot of the dog handlers, if their dog got bitten by another dog, they'd have to put it down.
Did you have your stire as well as a secondary?
No.
No, just a stire.
The gunners, just trying to think the first trip. I don't know if they had a secondary. Some of them have a 9mm, the gunners. But I don't think on the first trip we did. We had two grenades each.
For the secondary? The second trip?
First trip, and we had a rocket, 66 rocket launcher. It's like one of those ones you pull apart. Probably seen them. Rambo uses them all the time, but he keep using them. But it actually only has one use. Once you use it, we never needed to use them over there. But it was just in case. Like I said, we had gas masks as well for the first week, and then we thought, oh, we don't need these. But we also had what we called the wombat gun. Wombat.
Is that why you're a wombat?
No. it was the M79, so they used them in Vietnam as well. So they're like a grenade launcher. The second trip, we actually had GLAs, which is the Steyr, but it was connected onto the Steyr, the GLA. Yep. And that's how I damaged my hearing. But we had the old wombat guns, which we fired. You could fire a flare up, or you could fire a HE round. And there's actually a funny story about that when we were over there.
Yeah.
We got set really close to the border. This is the first trip. Really close to the border. And we had a trip flare. One of our trip flares that we had gone off.
Ugh.
And someone said, oh, it could have been a dog. And the guy said, well, I put it at chest height, so it wouldn't be a dog. And we went, oh, what are we going to do? And we thought, oh, you know what, let's put a loom up. And the guy that had the wombat gun, he said, oh, yep. And he got the orders to put one up. And he's put it in and he's fired it. And he's telling me when he fired it, went through his mind, he said, oh, hang on, did I put HE in that or did I put... And because usually you can tell when the flare goes up, it sort of cracks quicker and a HE takes a bit longer. And it was sort of a bit longer than usual when he's thinking. And then it went... And it was a flare. It took off. And he went, oh, thank goodness for that. You know, he was sort of... He said he was telling me later, his heart was pounding. I thought, oh, I think I just started World War III. But because it was right on the border, as soon as we sent the flare up, the Indonesian border just went berserk. All the you could see all the like spotlights, had these massive spotlights. A UN vehicle was going down the highway. He did a U-turn because they just panicked and they went the other direction. And then we could hear in the distance, like, movement and stuff. And I thought, oh, we couldn't see anyone. We pulled out of the area. We decided not to stay there. We started...
Do you think militia could have been there?
Well, I was talking to the guy that put the trip flare up. And he told me, oh, it's a pretty dodgy job. I wasn't really concentrating, so it could have been, could have pulled it, could have come loose itself, but we're not 100% sure. He sort of thinks, oh, maybe it was me that stuffed it and it just sort of gave way and come undone, but we don't really know. And we had one earlier, but we had it low and it went off. And we had a young Bushy with us. He was an Indigenous guy. He used to do a bit of tracking and stuff. And he reckons mm-hmm. it was a dog that actually hit it. He went and followed the tracks and stuff like that and worked out it was a dog that actually did that.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, so we had, yeah, the trip flares and stuff when they went off. You also had this really handy one where only you could only see it if you had night vision. It's sort of like a flash.
Mm-hmm.
So if they hit it, it's not like a flare or anything, it's just like a flash, and if you've got night vision on, you can actually see it.
Yeah, right.
We actually had night vision glow sticks as well. So the glow stick, you can't see it with the naked eye, but if you've got night vision on, you can actually see it.
Yeah, right, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
So, obviously you said the second trip was very different to the first one.
Yeah. A lot more bases, you had to wear blue hats.
Blue?
Yeah, UN, because the UN took over.
Yeah.
And so we had green patrols and blue patrols. So green patrol was when you're sort of in the bush looking for militia, probably more serious one where you sort of camouflage up and stuff like that. And then you have a blue patrol, which is telling the locals we're still here and we're still patrolling the streets. And that's where we used to... big difference was the people. There's heaps of people there the second time, whereas the first time... there wasn't as many. There was a bit on the border coming over. There was markets and stuff on the border and stuff like that. And we actually had a rush of people come at us at one stage on the border. But and we also had returnees coming towards the end of our trip. We weren't allowed to call refugees because the UN didn't like them calling them that because it was too warlike.
Right.
But they were refugees coming back. They were returnees, we called them.
Yeah.
And I remember we had these box of toys that we had and we saw a little kid. We said, hey, you can grab one. And then all of a sudden, all these adults come running at this box of toys, punching each other and pulling. They just wanted something to own because they had the militia come and take everything off them. They just wanted to own something. And if it was a little Pizza Hut toy that someone had sent over, they didn't care. They just wanted to own something. And the box was disintegrated. All the toys were gone. And there's a little girl lying on the ground crying, and we thought, we better not do this again. We better try and work it out a bit.
Fucking hell.
Different. Because water was another thing as well. They was after bottles of water and things like that. But the second trip, we had proper bases. We had cans of Coke and stuff like that. We could buy things. Couldn't drink still.
I remember going back to the toys. I think you've still got it in your wrestling bag.
Yes, I do, yeah.
Yeah, it's little got Casper. Little Casper.
Yeah. And I should have brought it.
Oh, give me 1 second. Got a full memory card, apparently.
Oh, yeah, hear that.
Apparently, yeah.
Yeah, so the second
trip... Some dumbass and delete shit.
What was a lot more different because you're more like a... bit like a policeman or security guard. Like you're sort of... Now you're peacekeeping. We were peacemaking the first time.
Mm-hmm.
We were making people... hand in weapons. We you know, there was bodies that we had to bury, stuff like that. There was.
So is that some of the stuff that sort of sit you there? Because obviously we've had that sort of conversation.
Probably the worst one I still have problems with today is a room I was made to sleep in.
Okay.
And it had I get triggered by the colour of the walls, which is sort of like a tan sort of colour. It was in Bellabo in a school.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so the militia used to use school bases. They used to take over the schools. That's where they executed people.
Right.
And I think it must have been like a sports hall or something, or a school hall. And we were made to sleep there one night, and all on the walls, it was sort of all back to back, was all these signatures. And what the militia made people do was they'd write their signatures in the blood and shit from their victims. And it was laid all across the walls and stuff. And I've had a lot of nightmares and stuff from that. That's probably one of the... And I've also seen the rape houses and stuff like that. I didn't see anything happen, but you'd walk in and you'd see where they'd raped the women. There was the bullet holes in the wall after they executed them. And there was like lipstick marks on the bottom. Because what they do is they used to put lipstick on the women, like full lipstick, and push their head against the wall to make them kiss it. And then they'd shoot them in the back of the head. And I sort of saw all the marks of that. And they actually had it on the wall. One of the guys interpreted it and said they were bragging about what they had done. And you saw all these things everywhere. And in that place, Balibo was pretty bad. A lot of bad stuff happened in Balibo. And what I was talking about earlier, about in 75, when those five journalists got killed.
Mm-hmm.
If you ever see the movie Balibo, people might see it, where the journalists actually paint an Aussie flag, I think it was with red paint, on the side of one of the buildings. Mm-hmm. And they were executed in that building later on. Well, we used to patrol past that building all the time.
Oh, wow.
So it was sort of our connection to history and that. Because before I went over there, I had no idea what Timor was. Parents said they heard of it in 75 and stuff like that, but they didn't really know much about it. And I was, you know, pretty naive back in those days. I thought it was near Fiji or something, but I had no idea where it was. But it's actually Southeast Asia.
Did that movie affect you at all?
I can't watch it.
No?
No, I tried. And just certain things that just, yeah...
That you know are real, so sort of...
Yeah, because I play Call of Duty and video games and stuff, and that really cool game. Was it Battlefield 42? What a waste of money that was.
2042.
And that's not going to give you flashbacks, because that was ridiculous. But I don't have problems with that sort of stuff, and I know some veterans probably would. I'm not sure, but I know a lot of guys that...
I know you enjoy those ones.
Yeah, I do. You enjoy them. But I can sort of... That's not real. I know it's not real. I mean, that real stuff, and I hear people
say... But the movie?
Oh, sorry?
But the movie, though?
Movies can be a little bit different, depending what it's on. Modern warfare stuff does give me a bit... Actually, even the modern Call of Duty campaign, the latest modern warfare one, 2019, I think it was, they had the night vision in it and that, and... There was little parts in that, but I actually ended up selling the game because I actually liked it. But
oh wow,
there's just parts of it I just couldn't do. And I know Cold War had a bit of night vision and stuff, but
does night vision really mess with you?
Because it was the first trip, especially because we used night vision every night, right? It was all the time, and it was like this green. It wasn't as clear as what it is in video games either. But it was like this green sort of glare, and everything you saw was night vision. So, yeah, it does stick with you a fair bit. And you used to get real heavy on that side, and you sort of have to pull it off every now and again to give your eye a rest. Yeah, it was... And it sort of nighttime was always a green glare.
So is that really messy then?
I didn't think it would, but with games and stuff sometimes. But, I mean...
It's not something you would expect to mess with you.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously it did, but you know.
Yeah, well, a lot of things. I think the small things, like, I did bury a couple of, well, they were skeletons, but they had all bullet holes in the same spot. They were all executed and they'd been put in the ocean. So when they washed up, we thought they were old, but they might not have been because they might have been eaten by crabs and things like that. Because the wildlife, like, there's a lot of sharks, crabs, even crocodiles in the ocean, and we used to go swimming out there. They used to let us swim the first trip. The second trip, there was a lot of rules. The first trip, there was no rules. We had shirts off and swimming naked down the beach, and if you had to be on guard, you had a guard duty, everyone... took turns on being guard duty, sitting naked with a machine gun, looking out to make sure there was no crocodiles or sharks or dead bodies. It was the big three: sharks, crocodiles, and dead bodies. We had to look for those sort of things while we're swimming in the ocean.
Yeah.
But the second trip, they stopped all that, and we had to wear long sleeves all the time. When I say we were shirts off, we didn't patrol down the streets like,
yeah,
you know, like in some Vietnam movie. But when we had downtime, we took shirts and that off. But the second trip, we weren't allowed to do that because I think we had a lot of people. I think it was about 90 people get malaria.
So
malaria was a really big issue, especially the second trip. We didn't get any cases, but they gave us a special medication, but we won't get into that because political, and a lot of us had a lot of issues with that medication, but we won't. I won't talk about that bit. But we had...
Well, you still get... Might be a little personal. Tell me... we used to get rashes. Is that from...
Yeah, I don't really know.
All that?
I don't know if it's got to do with that or not. Doctors aren't sure. They said it might be just your skin. We're not 100% sure with that, with the rashes and stuff. I mean, I always get like a sweat rash and stuff, but I get really bad in the grind. I think I had it for... just recently, I started to get a bit over it. I had a rash on my grind for 5 years straight.
Fuck.
And which you noticed, I probably scratched my balls a lot, but it wasn't actually. It was because I was in a lot of pain. And when I
did
come
you have
back
it prior?
The first time, sorry,
did you have it prior?
When I was over there, you did, yes. Because I reckon the first trip, the second day.
Not when you were a kid.
Not that I can remember, a little bit of heat rash in the armpits and stuff like that.
Okay.
And a little bit in the groin, but nothing like this. Nothing.
Yeah.
This. And when we were at the first trip, the second day or third day, I got my bayonet and I had to cut my underwear off and throw it because
fucking hell,
you rashed up that much. It started the rash around the underwear and it started to get. So we actually commandoed a fair bit.
Yeah, right.
Most guys chucked their undies the first day.
Fuck.
So if everyone's going down the bush and sees a whole heap of undies in the bush, they know why.
Mm. So, did 6 months trip. Obviously, you said that one affected you a little more.
The main thing that affected me with that one was we had a truck roll over. And I think that might have affected my driving and stuff as today. I'm getting a little bit better now. But like when I come back, I stopped driving for about 10 years.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, I still had my license. Still kept my license going. But I didn't drive much at all. Sort of drove when I had to, sort of thing. But we had a truck roll over, and it's sort of strange because I was in the vehicle in front, and they had, back in those days, we could still sit in the big bog trucks. Do you know? You might not know. The big trucks with the canopy over the top.
Yeah, I think I know what you're talking about.
And it's all different these days, but we had them, and we also had the 6Bs, and the 6B was a six-wheeled vehicle that you sort of had the seats facing out and a gunner on top. And I was on one of those. And then we had the MOG. We had a section in the back of the MOG and a cook and a medic. And then we had another 6B with another section in the back. And our rodeo was in the one in the MOG. And we're going on this patrol. We're going to get dropped off and go out field for about a week or 2 weeks or something.
Yep.
So we're driving along, and the roads, you got to remember, the roads over there were built in World War II and haven't really been maintained since.
Right.
So a lot of our vehicles were quite heavy, and we'd gone across, there's this real skinny bit. It was like a culvert underneath, you know, like a drain underneath.
Okay, yeah.
Underneath it. And the first vehicle I was in, and we went across, and I remember seeing the gunner sort of pulled his head down and sort of looked at me. I said, what's going on? He said, this looks a bit weird, like a bit unsafe. And we got across, and a sergeant jumped out of our vehicle and said, I better guide the big MOG across it. And he was guiding it. And then all of a sudden, the road just completely gave way. And the MOG truck rolled down the hill, down like it was a big, steep gully. It only rolled 1.5 times, but it felt like 10 times when I was there. And you could still hear them, the twisted metal as it rolled down the hill. We had our radio, we had troops in the back, we had all these containers and stuff, because they're going to drop us off, and then they're going to go into Dili, pick up some food supplies. The cook was going to come back to the main base that we had. It was in the mountains, so we were actually going up quite steep area, and the other guys got caught on the other side. Our radio got completely destroyed, so we couldn't have any comms back to anybody to get any help or anything like that. So the guy in the back reversed his vehicle all the way down, reversed it, couldn't turn around, he reversed all the way down the mountain.
Fuck.
And then he span around and he went and got help.
How are the people in the morgue?
Yeah, so I was a combat first aider at the time, so I was infantry, but I'd been trained in a 2-week course, apparently to prepare you for the worst. So I had medical kit and stuff like that. Our medic was actually in the accident, so he was no good. I sort of ran down the hill, and he was underneath a container. I thought he was dead at first, to be honest. I couldn't see his legs weren't moving. His legs were hanging out. Another guy was hung over a rock. He looked like in a movie, you know, when someone gets shot and they fall over a rock. Yeah, that's what it looked like. I thought he was dead, to be honest. And then it all started to, as just sort of adrenaline sort of kicks in, then you start, okay, I've got to start helping and start doing stuff. And it was a bit of shock at first. You could smell diesel, and it was running down the hill from the truck. There was grenades rolling around everywhere, out of people's webbing and stuff had come loose. A machine gun was bent like a banana. It'd actually been, there's rounds everywhere. There was a couple of Timorese people saw it. They started cutting down bamboo to use for a stretcher. Mm-hmm. I had a stretcher cover in my, because I was CFA, so I had a stretcher cover, so we used that. There was guys had cuts and things. One guy had his nails ripped out, like, you know, his fingernails were ripped out. One guy was quite lucky. He got big cut across his head, but he, I don't know how he did it, but he's he had a rail over him, but because his webbing sort of pushed it up a bit, and he just slid out of his webbing, and he was right. He could just slide, and his webbing was sort of stuck underneath the truck. He was under the truck, but he could slide out. So he was very lucky. A lot of guys were sliced open. We had all survivors. We didn't think so at first. I thought we had a...
Well, you wouldn't have thought so.
You don't know. And it was... Then we had realised that... one guy said, I can't feel my legs. And we go, okay, he's spinal. And then we had another one, he's spinal as well. And then we realised the guy was yelling out. I said, where the hell is that coming from? It was, he actually got thrown out up the top of the hill. When the truck rolled, one guy tried to jump out, the canopy wrapped around his leg and dragged him back in. The guy that was trying to stay in, he got thrown out. So he ended up at the top of the hill, and he had a dislocated knee and a broken leg.
Yeah, right.
And I gave him the green Penfrain whistle. And so he had made himself feel a little bit better there. But then we had to try and get these other guys out.
Bad broke?
Yeah, but I could... Yeah, it was, I think. Yeah, it was sort of... I'm just trying to remember. Dislocated knee.
His leg would have been like off to the side or something.
His leg or, I know he had two injuries, but I can't remember if it was... dislocated knee, and I'm sure it was a broken leg or something. I just can't quite remember, because a lot of things happened that day. There was a lot of guy with injuries and cuts and stuff.
Yeah,
sliced open, and there's a guy, we used to call him Pretty Boy, Pretty Roy Boy, and he wasn't pretty anymore because he had a big slash across his face. And
fuck.
And we had this guy that couldn't move his legs, and one couldn't feel anything at all. And so we got the stretcher, and we had to stretcher him up a big slant like that. And the way you do it is we had, I think, three guys on each side of the stretcher. Then you have three guys behind, and one would run around the front, take the first bit, and then the next guy would run and take the next bit. And we sort of just slowly went. It took us a long time to get him up
over
the hill. And eventually I saw the Russians flew past first, and they just kept going. And then Australian helicopters and stuff started to land, and then we had other vehicles coming. Well,
that would have been hard, wouldn't it? Because it was all bushy.
No, it wasn't too bad. It was too bad. Okay. A lot of the, like, like people say it's like the jungle and stuff, but a lot of it was sort of more scrublandy, and it's sort of like it wasn't sort of your thick jungles like Vietnam, but there's parts that were, but this area was. This is up in the mountains, so it was sort of the biggest problem they had was probably how to land, because it was quite rough. And but usually you'd fly, the Kiwis would fly, Kiwis were best at it, they'd fly in and land on anything.
Especially a sheep.
No sheep jokes, we don't want to have them over there. Especially when they had to fly you and take you home, you wouldn't joke about that sort of thing. But yeah, we had all sorts of nationalities and stuff. And I'll tell you a bit about the Russian pilots a bit later, because that's pretty funny. But this big accident really took it out of, I think, all of us, and obviously the guys that were in it. And we lost a whole section out of it.
Fuck.
And they come back, and I think we went on a patrol probably a couple of months later, and one of the guys who didn't seem to have an issue, all of a sudden his nerves started to go, have spasms and stuff. So he had to, after it, so he actually was an effect of what after. He was fine, but later on he got the effects.
Yeah, right, that's crazy. Yeah,
so it was, and we were there for probably nearly a whole day trying to clean it all up. And I remember they got all the guys out, they flew them out, and we had the recce crew, like the recovery guys, come do a wonderful job. And they had this vehicle, and they had to try and get this truck out. It was an absolute mess, and they had to get this truck out. And I remember this military policeman come, and he had to sort of organize it all, and he had to do an investigation. And he was telling us that he'd only been there for 26 days, and this was his 23rd accident.
Fuck.
And this was the worst one he's ever seen, since each one got worse gradually. And the problem was our roads, our vehicles were getting more and more vehicles over there. The TMREs were starting to get vehicles, and the roads weren't handling it very well.
Yeah.
Especially in these mountainous areas. A lot of these older roads hadn't been touched at all. And so engineers did bridges and things like that, but a lot of big main roads and stuff. I mean, you got to remember the TMREs didn't have a lot of money for that kind of stuff.
So yeah. How was it coming home from that trip then, with all that happening?
Yeah, because I was over there, was going to transfer over to medical, because I wanted to become a medic and try and do more things, to help people and stuff like that. I think that's just the way I am. And I also did the gap between the first trip and the second trip, I was actually in pipes and drums for a bit, and I was learning how to play bagpipes and also be a combat first aider. And I ended up getting pushed. They closed pipes and drums down for the second trip, and they sent us all back into infantry roles, which didn't worry me, because I just hadn't been in infantry that long ago, so it didn't sort of worry me too much. But some of the guys that have been there for 15 years panicked. But I got into the section quite well, and everything was really good, and I was the combat first aider and stuff. And I thought, you know what, I could go further with this. I could probably do this outside eventually as well. So I went medical. And when I come back, I pretty much went straight on a medical course. So I really didn't have time to reflect on it too much. And I think a lot of the things that happened, I did the first two trips so close together. And then I did a medical course, and we had some issues the first one. I had to redo it. And when I got back to come to Brisbane, actually, and my depression just hit me in 2004. So I really was sort of never had a break, and I was sort of like all this action was happening. And when I got to a place where everything was just stopped, there was no action, there was nothing much happening. I hit a brick wall. And everything just started to come flooding back, and all the memories and things like that. And so I've had a major depression since 2004. 2005, I thought I was better, and I sort of got back into things. And then 2006, I did an operating theater course. So helping surgeons, army surgeons, with the equipment and stuff like that. And then I had another massive breakdown. And then I was kicked out of the army after that.
So, when did they give you the, like, yep, you've got PTSD?
That was only a couple of years ago, just before.
Oh, wow, really?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Hold on. Gunther just came back.
Yep.
Continue.
Yeah, so, So, sorry, where were we?
When you just got diagnosed with PTSD.
Yeah. So, the problem I had when I left the army, I had a lot of issues with other jobs. I ended up working in a nursing home for 3 years. Then I went and worked for my father at a caravan park and didn't get along with his manager that he had there. Then I worked for a surveyor and got treated a little poorly there.
Okay.
I was there for 3 years though. I just put up with it. I always just put up with things. I just kept going. Didn't matter. People put me down. I kept going. And then I walked out of that job. Then because I did a bit of reenacting, I actually went to Europe and did a bit of reenacting. So I did the reenactment of Waterloo. And I've also done one. I've done Waterloo once before in 2011. This is when I was out of the army. I used to do reenacting. I used to do battle reenactments. Also did American Civil War as well.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was at this Waterloo one.
Sorry, I just want to apologize for the birds. Doing my head in too. But they're being extra vocal today.
That's all right. And when I did my reenacting, it was sort of like staying with the military sort of side of things. And I really enjoyed it. I loved history. I loved learning about that stuff. But when I was in Waterloo for the 200th anniversary, I actually had a breakdown while I was over there.
Yeah.
Because guys are pretending to be sergeants and yelling at you and stuff like that. And I just took it realistically and I just snapped. Yeah, I snapped over there. And so it wasn't the actual the reenacting of the fighting or anything. It was just the lifestyle and living in tents again. And it was just weird. It just sort of started to get triggered.
Yeah.
And then I went for a long trip after that. Saw about 14 different countries. I went on this trip around Europe and stuff like that. And that was really good. Come back and got another job where I met my lovely partner, Nadia. She worked at the same place. But I started to have issues there with other people. Had a breakdown there. Another one. I nearly punched a guy and stuck him in an autoclave. So I was probably time to leave. And then each job, I worked with you guys there for a while too.
Mm-hmm.
Also the ATO, believe it or not, I worked for them. And I worked for you guys, and then I worked for a call center, and that was it. I blew out. I only lasted 2 weeks there. And the doctor said, we need to fix this. You've actually got PTSD. And because I had this doctor that said I was doing fine, and I didn't think I was, but I sort of thought, oh, he's a doctor, he must know. But I went to someone else eventually, because I was sort of told to by another veteran.
I mean, I always thought he did, from just the stories you were telling me when we're on trips and shit.
Yeah.
I'm like, man, you've got it for sure.
Yeah, and I think, remember when Rufio was training us one time, and I had a blow up at him and stuff, and it's nothing against the person, but I just...
Yeah, Rufio is very... I don't know, very full-on coach. He's back now, by the way.
Oh, is he?
Yeah. But yeah, and I could just see it of whining at you.
Yeah, yeah. And I guess, like, I used to take a lot of criticism and stuff a lot, and I think over time I just got sick of it. And nothing against these guys that are training you up or anything. I think I took a swing at Jesse once. I don't think he remembers, but I thought, oh, yeah, I'll have a crack, see what happens. But but there was a couple of times where I had breakdowns and stuff, and a lot of people didn't understand. And I think mentally I thought everyone was judging me, but no one was. But in my mind, I thought everyone was. And I nearly didn't end up wrestling. I nearly quit. But I paid so much money on this damn costume, I decided to stay. And I wasn't sure how far I was going to go with the wrestling. Like, I thought, we'll do one match and see how we go. And,
well, how'd you start it?
So a mate of mine was talking to me at a pub and said, you know, you need hobbies in your your reenacting is really good, but maybe you should do another sport, maybe something. You love watching wrestling on TV. Why don't you have a crack at that? I thought, I don't know if there's any clubs in Australia, so, or Brisbane anyway. And I looked it up on the internet, which I'm not very good at, but I found one, and it ended up being Mason.
Mm.
And I ended up going down training at Braid Park, and I remember one day they rang up, they had no referee for Eagleby for a fight, and they said, oh, can you come down and referee for us? And I said, oh yeah, I'll give it a go. See what happens. And so I refereed for a few matches, all the matches down for that, and then I actually refereed at a couple other matches, and then I went away. That was when I went to work for my dad at 2011. I worked for my dad at the caravan park, and I get a phone call from Jesse Daniels and said, oh, we need a referee. We're going to the Rocky show to wrestle. Can you do it? I said, oh yeah, I'll do that. So I went and refereed for that, and thought, oh gee, I missed this a little bit, and was having problems in Rocky, and quit my job there, and I actually ended up, I got pissed off at my dad, went over to Europe, I just went and reenacted. This is not the 2015, it's 2011, but it was Waterloo, but a smaller scale. And I went over, and I come back, and a mate, when I was in Dubai, rang me and said, got a job for you in Rocky, just to clean my hotel. So I did that for a couple of months until I moved back down to down to Rocky, and then I got back into, I think 2012, I really hit the training pretty hard. In 2013, I ended up wrestling. We had the marsupial militia. I've been marsupial militia a couple. There's been a couple of marsupial militias, but that was the first one, and that was when I had that sort of that breakdown. I was going to quit, and then I thought, oh, I spent so much on this costume, and I better give it a go. And then it just sort of, oh, this is not too bad, and I kept doing it, and ended up, Jag asked me to go down to South Australia and do a bit of training with him down there and wrestle down there. And
I've actually spoken to a few boys in Adelaide, and they remember you.
Oh, do they?
Yeah, they remember you.
And there was also Jonah Rock. Also, his other name, what is it?
He's Jonah now anyway.
Sorry?
He's back to being Jonah now.
Is he? Oh, yeah. Good. So I don't have to swap names all the time.
Yeah, he was Bronson Reed in WWE.
Yeah.
Now he's, I think he's in Melbourne in a couple of weeks.
Oh, he's coming back, has he?
He's coming back, yeah. He's taking international bookings again.
Right.
So he'll be back for Renegades of Wrestling.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So, yeah, that, and he was great too, and I was actually wanted to wrestle him, actually, but never got the chance.
One day, maybe.
Maybe, wow.
Before you retire?
Yeah, well, I've actually been retired for about 2 or 3 years, so, yeah.
Yeah. Retiring until wrestling.
Yeah, well, I used to think that Dad retired kickboxing at 42, but I just found out it was 47. He started in 42, at 42, so I've still got a few years to get. He keeps teasing me about it, but... But I said, yeah, I've actually won championships, so, you know, I'm better.
Oof.
Yeah.
Oof. Oh, sadly, we never did. But that's
no, we didn't.
We promised it 1,000 times.
Ah, well, that's...
But we might as well get into that. So, obviously, I started as Dolphin.
Yeah.
Yay. You're actually part of my first match without realizing this is sort of how it's going to happen. So, it was you, me, Slammer, and Super Chico.
Oh, yeah.
And we faced Xander, that's JL, Hamish, and Seeker.
That was at Caboolture, wasn't it?
That was Caboolture.
Yeah.
So that's sort of how I started there. Good match. We won. The Luchas. And then I just had like one match against Slammer and Five Star Flash as a dark match. And then we had the Australia Day show. It was me versus Slammer with your special guest referee. So without realizing, we were sort of... coming together without realizing it was coming together again.
And it sort of made sense, I guess.
And then, it did. And then...
because we didn't have many masked guys at that stage when you came in, did we?
I think it was you, me, Hugh, Slammer, and Super Chico. I think that was it. I think Koi came back every now and then.
Because when I first debuted, nearly everyone was masked.
Yeah.
And then it's sort of now I think I'm the only one left. But
I mean, Mason, I come back every now and then. Yeah, Mason's still going.
Mason's still...
I got my trainee, Cody Clark.
Yeah.
They've got him under a hood.
but it was all masks. It was all gimmicks. And it was a lot of fun, especially at Tribal. I don't know if you ever went to the Tribal
ones. Never went to Tribal.
No. Well, no, you were in...
I was New Globe.
Yeah, because we were actually a family show to start with, but then people said, oh, because we had alcohol there and people complained, so we ended up...
Cut back.
You cut back and said, oh, it's adults only, but...
I think we... Yeah, we did. We main evented the first show back at Bray Park. It was you and me versus Bobby and Rip.
Yeah.
In the main. Was it the main or semi-main?
Yeah.
Might be semi-main. But yeah. I know we were a big deal for that show. Because we went to like the markets and shit to promote it.
Oh, that's right. We did. Was that long ago?
We did that a couple of times. Yeah.
Yeah, we did. Yeah.
So that sort of just
faded away though, didn't it?
We
sort of did a lot of that.
So it's sort of like, oh, we'll put, you know, your Wombat did that thing, so we'll put you together for a match.
Yeah.
And it sort of went well. So they put us into another one. And I'm like, look, I'm just going to make a booking for ourselves here. Went to the, I think it was Jesse.
Yeah.
Might have been somebody else who was announcing at the time. And I'm like, let me come out. Call Surf N Turf. Might have been Gary. I'm like, call Surf N Turf. Yeah. He's like, oh, okay. And then like, sort of like, put together like, from where the land meets the sea and...
Yeah, that's right. We had...
combined weight of $50 per kilo.
Yeah, that's right. We did too, yeah.
Put it together.
Yeah, we went to Sydney and...
That was the next thing I was going to talk about. So, like, we started picking up momentum and we became, like, fan favorites pretty quickly because we were putting a lot of effort into the team itself. And then not long after, we got the very first promo we did where you were teaching me English.
Yeah.
We were notorious for our promos. Then B-Boy called me and said that he wanted us to tag. And we thought we were going down there for, like, a... decent match. Found out it was SMS who were the PWO tag champs at the time, as well as the Wrestling Go tag champs. And we're like, oh yeah, it'd be fun match, you know, look forward to it. Who was it? Thinking about Jordan. He's like, he walked up and like, oh, 20 minutes for the main boys. I'm like, oh, good on him. He's like, no, no, we are the main. I'm like, what?
Yeah.
Like, no, we're the main.
That's right.
I'm like, what?
We were the main. We didn't even know.
I went to B-Boy and I'm like, I thought you said we were opener. He's like, oh, nah, main.
It, yeah.
I'm like, what?
Yeah.
Like, that was our first interstate trip, which, by the way, I found the footage of. B-Boy found us the footage of the match.
Yeah.
We found it. That was probably one of my favorite tag matches ever because that was a fun match.
We went against the school boys too. What were they called? The
prefects. We went against the prefects.
Yeah, I liked that one.
Everyone thought you were going to do a dive.
Yeah.
That was a good spot that we liked doing. I'd do a dive and then you'd come in and you're like, nah. Jump out to the butt.
Yeah.
We had a lot of momentum as a team. And a lot of my, like, the way I am with characters and stuff, I thank you for. Because...
Yeah.
The travel, the driving to the shows themselves. Like, you taught me a lot about being a character and working it.
Yeah.
Obviously, Dolphin grew a lot from it. But even now, Zach Reynolds, I still take bits and pieces of what you taught me.
Yeah. You'll see a lot of it. I did the reenacting and stuff as well. And I think that's and like, even when I was in pipes and drums in the army, and I wanted to be a soldier and stuff, but I always had this passion of history and tradition and sort of with the wrestling and the reenacting, sort of a bit of showmanship as well.
Mm.
And I think even pipes and drums was a bit of showmanship as well in there. And I'm a fairly, when I'm not wearing this, I'm a fairly quiet sort of person and don't really carry on like a dickhead too much. But when I got this on, I just let it rip.
Oh, look, we had so many fun times as a tag team. I never really wanted it to end.
No, but everything does end. And yeah, unfortunately.
I just wish we had a bit more control on it ending.
Yeah, but...
Like, we promised the tag titles multiple times, and realistically, the amount of times they should have pulled the trigger and didn't, I think it kind of hurt. Yeah. It hurt us, but I think it hurt what was going on because we were so hot at the time. Which, you know, that sucked. Because, like, obviously, we'll talk about it. Our promos.
Yeah.
I'll get some up because they were a lot of fun. This one, it was number two of a four-part series.
Yeah, that's right. Yep, I remember this one.
It's one of my favorite ones.
Yeah, so you rang me and said, we need to do this, but I need empty alcohol containers. And I said, leave it with me. I can work that out. I actually went down to the bottle-o and I got a fair bit of alcohol and I drank it all that night to make sure I had empty containers.
Worst part was, is that we did it, did the four-part series, and then we were told that we need to do it again.
Yeah, like, that's right.
More cans, more bottles.
So that was another six-pack I had to drink. Yeah, so if I become an alcoholic, I'm blaming AWA for that.
Yeah, so this is number two. The whole thing was we got high, that's drunk, right, and had a party. And this is the aftermath.
Deal a bomb. Oh, what the bloody... Who drank all this?
What a story it was with you and me walking to the park in our gear.
Yeah. Oh, son of a kangaroo.
The car's driving past, must have been freaking out.
Yeah. People looking at us. I don't know what these people in this house over here thought of us doing that. It's pretty loud.
Oh, Dol. I think we drank a bit much. Hey, Dol.
Right there, I'm trying so hard not to laugh.
Oh, yeah, actually. I know. Harpoon! Woo-hoo! That worked. You're off, mate.
I'm just trying to get you off. Yeah, I've got a bit of sore
head too, mate. Revolution, mate. Revolution, we need...
Yeah. Oh, wait. Isn't that, like, soon?
Yeah, yeah. We finally found out last night.
Where's your phone, mate?
Didn't
we leave it in the
surf and
truck,
Bill? Oh, yeah, Sarge.
We ran out somewhere last night.
Yeah, Sarge has got that.
What the?
Yeah, Sarge, we'll go get Sarge, hey? Let's go get the car.
Okay.
Yeah,
alright.
Start. Yeah,
oh,
let's
man.
Go.
Okay.
Oh.
No,
Dolph,
mate.
You're not. Then also, we had Nick come through. Yeah. No, where's the next part? Here he is.
Oh, yeah, mate. Why'd you have to get part three? Oh, look, mate, it was just to get you off, you know. Yeah, let's find the car. It's over here. Oh, dude.
What?
Dude! That's where's my car? Dude, where's your car? Dude, where's my car?
Dude, where is your car?
Dude, where's my car? Sarge, where is it?
Why have you been drinking?
I don't know. You've got something. Is that your phone?
Maybe.
Oh, wait, no, this is your phone.
My phone?
Bloody Sarge.
You've been a bad wombat. Come here. What's on there?
Well, it's some photos.
Yeah, just a tick.
Whoa.
Oh,
that's
I don't know how you did that.
Did you really ride Sarge?
Yeah.
Jesus. Wait, there's a couple of texts up here. Yeah, there's one private number. We're going to kick your ass. Ha ha ha.
Yeah, that's usual. That always happens. Yeah.
went to the gym guy, former AWA heavyweight champion.
Ego. What an ego.
No, I think he means weight.
Oh, yeah. Oh, gee.
The photos as well.
Well, let's go there.
Now, the funny part about that one was that the first take on that, there was a dog in the fence. And as we walked past...
Yeah, I forgot about that.
As we walked past... The dog runs to the fence, stop, and a wombat shit a brick.
Yeah.
It was jumped into my arms.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember that.
And then, oh, this is a good one.
Rubber tub tub, wombat's having a scram.
I forgot about this.
Scratching your ass.
Oh, look at that change. Oh, honey.
Dolphin
had
a heart attack when he sees that.
A shark. Hoorah! A shark
tower. Hoorah!
The hoorah doorbell.
Hoorah!
Yeah,
that's the thing with that. So I always hit my head on the door. A wombat would hit me in the head. That wasn't even... That was an accident.
Yeah,
I didn't even hit myself in the head. So like, you, bang.
So used to doing it. Yeah. You actually did it anyway.
It was me. I think it's, that was my parents' house. And just bang. Cracked myself in the head. Yeah. I have to admit, new gear was good. And the comfy seat.
Yeah, that's right.
Always had to... Sit at the comfy seat.
Oh, seat to myself. Hey, Sarge, are you alright? I thought I heard something.
Dressed
oh,
dog.
Oh, jeez. What are you doing, mate?
We're wearing a towel.
I'm moving to tell you my final destination, remember? At the match? Oh, that's this week.
Yes, this weekend.
Oh,
at the zoo.
Yeah, okay, so who we got? Who we got?
I don't know, and who have you got?
I don't know, that's where you're right.
Yeah,
you
haven't got a match.
No, I haven't got a match. Oh, that's a bit of a shame.
Yeah, I know.
So you, for the end of the year and final destination, have number one contendership for the AWA Heavyweight Championship. You got Rufio and Jesse Daniels.
Son of a kangaroo.
Wombat,
mate,
towel. What?
Towel,
mate,
oh,
towel.
He's wearing his
suit
anyway.
Oh, Rufio.
Oh,
yeah,
oh,
Rufio.
Oh,
it's Rufio there. Yeah, it's Rufio. I'd love, like, the psychology behind that. It's like, you wear your suit anyway, but because you dropped your towel.
Yeah.
Then we got, it's probably one of my favorite ones. I found this and I'm like, oh, I got it. I had a good mind for this shit.
That's
right. Yeah, mate, I have to stop it there. I think they got that wrong. Caring. I don't know where they pulled that. That's right. But
most of these were one take.
So I reckon that
we're pretty good with it.
Their noises and stuff. I reckon I could. We reckon we could get Dolphin over? What do you reckon? I'll have a crack. Hoorah! Hoorah!
What do you know?
Hoorah! 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 Good to see you. You got the watermelon still, mate.
Watermelon
just watching
title.
You know about the dolphins and your the way you communicate and all that stuff.
Why?
Yeah, really. Oh, I'm bored. Really, I don't know. Anyway, come in. Yeah, sorry about that.
That's
all I don't know what keeps going. Anyway, come in.
Fuck, that sounded solid.
Yeah, close the door, mate. We don't want Sars getting the cold. You know what he's like. You just sit there for stand there, yeah? I just want to make sure you don't take me sick.
I see you got a new stuffy touch shirt.
Yeah, you like it? Actually, come to think of it, where's yours?
Oh, give me a sec.
Oh, there we go. Shirt's on the spot, the arms.
Yeah. The reason I'm here, I didn't hear you call me or anything about documentary. I did get a message from AWA management, though. Oh, there we go.
Felt so bad for your phone.
Yeah. All right, so let's go open.
Good thing you got a new one.
Yep. Okay, we have. I forgot your name.
but there's no one.
Oh, that's Triple X. Well, we've got singles matches, I think.
You've got... You're part of the Next Level tournament.
Yep, and you've got...
I've got...
You've got triple question mark there.
There's an asterisk next to it.
Yeah, we're slurring words. No match.
You know what? No. This can work, though. Because you've got your singles. You can win the title. That's sweet. You know, that's cool. You can beat Nova. We can be Next Level. That's fine. But for me, what can I do? You know, I want to match this puzzle. How about I do an open challenge?
That's good. That'll work.
I'll send a message later.
That'll work. Let's get to the training, eh? Let's go.
I remember this promo, but I can't remember the match with the promo.
Good
on ya. Is this really necessary?
Yeah, of course it is, mate.
Hell!
Oh, tips are good for me biceps, mate.
Oh, really? Mate, it's called, the show's called Sky's Limit, not weighing me down. Come
Let's
on.
Go.
Oh.
Hello!
I can't remember who you had. But I remember I had a match. It was me, Jesse and Hamish, or Jackson Cross. I had that triple threat.
Oh, okay.
And I think you were like the match alpha. Oh, okay, right? So you didn't come out with me. But I remember like, you know what? I'll be your manager. I think you had a triple threat as well. I can't remember who it was with.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I'll be your manager. So I rock up. Dolphin, it was hot as balls in that building.
Yeah.
And I wear a tie and a blazer. Oh, and I walk out with you. And I'm like, yeah. Real show fun for you.
That too, mate. Where was it? What building was it?
Same place where Knifel is. Rangba.
Oh, okay.
Mm, yeah, yeah. Can't remember who you had. Might have been you and Adonis and somebody else.
Right, yeah. Yeah.
But yeah, that was funny. Now, obviously, sadly, we split.
Yeah, as all tag teams do.
Again, I wish we had more control. Because again, I don't know. With Todd booking at the time, he had said that there was tag titles coming. But someone got jealous because I was doing the Zach Reynolds character.
I think, you know, things change. Like with wrestling, I've learnt that things tend to change very quickly. People get injured and these things move and this changes. So
I think the bit that sucked for us the most, though, is we just dropped $1,000 on merch.
Oh, that's right.
So that show, Wombats here, throwing out stickers, throwing out shirts.
I was throwing t-shirts out everywhere, wasn't I? Yep.
Yeah. Because no one knew what was going on.
Yeah. At least I had Christmas presents for me nephews that year. Yeah, that's true. Sorted pretty
early. But yeah, so we did that. You had the match with Jesse and Rufio. Jesse attacked you. I came out for the save.
Oh, that's... Yeah, yeah. Then you did the nasty and kicked me.
Yeah. Shuggy's hand scared Jesse off. And then I kicked you in the face.
Yeah.
And I just remember that... It went like dead quiet.
Yeah.
Like a pin could drop. And then they reacted.
Yeah.
And then
yeah.
It went quiet again. Because they're like, what the fuck did we just see? No yeah, one yeah. thought it was ever going to happen.
Yeah, didn't think it was going
to happen. No one thought it was ever going to happen. And then, yeah, ripped the mask off. People are like, oh fuck, wait, that's the ref. Because I was a ref prior. Like, oh fuck, that's the ref. Big fuck you, Zach chant.
Yeah, because you used to ref as well. At the.
Not at that time. So we stopped right when we knew... It was
becoming a team, but you did a lot of the music as well, didn't you?
Did the music,
refereeing, and you wrestled with me for a while, like,
and the editing. Yeah.
Editing. Oh yeah, yeah.
Did everything. A lot of hats. And that happened, and that started the Daniel's Republic, which I didn't really want to be a part of, and was only part of for like two shows anyway.
Oh, that's right.
Got put through a table.
Yeah, yeah.
And then the thing that pissed me off the most. Is we had that match. We had this big build up, big hype package.
Yeah.
Which I wish I had, because that hype package was amazing.
Yeah.
We finally had a singles against each other. And yeah. A match time got cut. And we were like, oh, we'll have this big story that'll lead into homecoming. Because like realistically, whether or not people will admit it, we're easily top tag team in the company, if not Queensland at the time.
Right.
And we could have pushed that story out to homecoming. And I think that's where, that's what we thought was going to happen. So I had like army vets and cadets teed up for a special entrance.
Yeah.
Like we had so much shit planned for that. And it was going to be I could just get the way that crowd was that night too at that homecoming. Yeah. That'd have been crazy. That'd been fucking crazy.
What actually did happen to homecoming?
It was you, me, Rip Bobby versus fucking Jesse Love Zero.
So the Homecoming Cup, that's the one where we had like the
Dragon of Seeker.
Is that the Rumble though? We do have a Rumble for that.
We usually do, but yeah, we were in the 8-man, and then Flash was the special guest.
Ah, right, yep.
Yeah, yeah. But so that singles, we'll watch it. Obviously, I was very fresh as Reynolds, so don't critique me. I already have 1,000 times. But like we had fun, so yeah,
that was the zoo too, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. Zoo. Dog's going nuts.
Fucking hell.
So yeah, 6 minutes. So we weren't too happy. We weren't too happy. And the crowd was hot for this match. Actually, I think you remember. This was the first match you ever had a holy shit chant, wasn't it?
I think so, yes.
I think every time you've had a holy shit chant, Yeah, it was just you and I.
I just can't remember. Like, I know I had a jag. We had a lot of noise, but that was also nervous against him. Yeah. I can't remember too much of what the crowd was doing, but.
I think it needed to be.
Yeah.
I think I've eaten more of those shots than anybody else. Always know how to hit the butt.
Yeah.
Lucha.
Oh, that's
right. I'm just over here. I'm like, what the fuck was that? You never did that with me. You've done it 1,000 times.
Yeah, I know. I kind of did it all the time. Yeah, I don't know.
Oh, you ate this.
Oh, yeah.
I technically won there.
I forgot about those guys were out there, actually.
Yeah, a bit low.
No, good crowds, though.
God, I'm happy I'm a lot more violent now with that. Sorry,
yeah. Yeah, I think I really lost my
I think it's the first time I ever threw this. I think it was the best one I ever threw.
Was that the first time you did that?
That kick, yeah.
I'm actually surprised I let you do something for the first time.
Different character. We've had a couple matches since, and yeah, it's just obvious that we click well. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It was worse when I used to wear this one.
Yeah.
I actually had a guy, Johnny Lucas, rip that completely off.
Speaking of trying to rip the mask off. I think it was a big thing within our story. Mm-hmm. Oh, this pissed me off. They wanted to get part of it, and I wanted them to have nothing to do with it. I wanted to be you and me. That was it. Here we go.
What was that? One more time.
Six more times.
Six. Yeah, we used to have a thing where they used to count seven times they wanted us to do something. That comes from the Globe, didn't it? The Globe when that first started?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, that was so hot. It was so hot for us. Ooh, my second too. Oh, big kick out. The thing is, the rivalry never really stopped either. Whenever you and I were in the same match, it was always the focal point.
Yeah, even in the Rumbles too.
Mm.
I didn't realise that this was so long ago, you know.
And the crowd was so into it as well. Like, they... The crowd always knew Surf N Turf. Got greedy. Should have pinned you off the kick. They hadn't seen my finisher before. Oh, this pop. What a pop.
And the winner of this match.
And he ended up being my tag team.
Yeah.
We had, he's doing quite well for himself too now, I think. Wrestling, but.
You know, that was a fun time.
Yeah.
And I think we've come together. Once we've come back together.
Where was that? That was a wide base.
Phrase pop.
Yeah, that was for that. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
And we had Billy Mack with us as well.
Yeah, Billy Mack came with us for that one. Yeah. Because we had a tag match,
the guys
and then
from Rocky come down.
Mm.
Yeah, that was actually another surprising show. Oh, I did not expect it to be the way it was.
Mm. Oh, I had a rough feeling because I was helping.
Yeah,
with
right.
That shit then.
Yeah, because and I mean those. Oh, it's been a bit rough the last few years with those sort of things because of what's happened, and you know you had these, always went to the big supernovas and stuff, and when I heard these small ones, I don't know if this is going to be any good, but. Both
that's
the ones, Wide Bay, like the Wide Bay one and the Gladstone one, and the Gladstone one was pretty impressive. Like, it wasn't just in one area; it was quite. They blocked off a street and everything, so
yeah.
It was quite big. And the sort of cosplay was quite large there.
Yeah.
Which, when I was a kid, I can never remember that stuff. But like I was talking about when, you know, at school and stuff, you know, if you got called gay and things like that, if you did. Dungeons and Dragons or cosplay or anything like that, you'd get called that and get picked, and all of a sudden now cosplay is like a mainstream thing.
Yeah.
Like comic books when I was a kid was very nerdy and sort of looked at as a loser sort of thing. Whereas now it's, I don't know if it's the same level as football or that, but they even footballers and that look at comics and Star Wars movies and things like that. Well, if you watch Star Wars, you were on the outside, you know.
Mm.
Dungeons and Dragons, all those things. Like, it's completely different now.
Yeah. Well, you still got a lot of life left in you when it comes to wrestling.
Yeah.
I think.
We'll see.
Well, like, I think people know how to protect you.
Yeah.
Look after you.
Well, I do go to the gym 3 days a week now. Mm. I don't do as much training as I used, like. It's a little bit harder as you get older, and you'll find out as you get older. Your body does.
I'm feeling it now,
so
mate.
What age are you now?
22.
So you've still got a few real.
I'm still feeling
years.
It though.
Yeah, you'll feel that. But see, I didn't wrestle until I was in my
30s. Yeah, right.
And sometimes I wish I could have started when I was in my 20s. And we always say, "Oh, I could have been really great this and that," but you don't really know. But you are the person who you are from your experiences that you've done. Mm. And like, the Combat Wombat is shaped from wrestling and it's from my experiences as a soldier and the sort of, also, like you said, as a country kid, you know, growing up Rockhampton around cattle, horses, I rode a lot of horses, I actually look after horses now, and that all become that sort of iconic sort of Combat Wombat, sort of putting it all into one.
Yeah. Well, like, when it comes to Surf N Turf, obviously did a lot for my wrestling career. So I was like, can't thank you enough for that one. What was your outlook on Surf N Turf? Because obviously you went from not really doing a whole heap to now with Surf N Turf, it sort of just put both of us on this level that we didn't expect.
Well, we also had, I had another run with
Battle Toad.
Battle Toad. Now, this wasn't the first battle, so we had two Battle Toads. We had the Marsupial Militia for our second sort of comeback, which is weird because the toad isn't marsupial, but...
That's all right.
I don't know what was going on there, but I did have a koala there at one stage as well. And that sort of faded away, but then it came back, and we had a pretty good run there. And were you were around there then? You were just doing the music for that.
I saw the very end
of
you and Battletoad.
Yeah, Battletoad. Yeah, and
because shit happens.
Yeah, and then I had to move on and have another. I was with Hugh for a while as well.
Yeah, so Hugh replaced Toad for about a couple of shows.
Yeah, and so, and then eventually, he bloody turned on me too, didn't he?
No, he's been. They went to put him in yellow title and heavyweight title.
I have a lot of partners turn on me a bit. But anyway, so we went there, and then after that, was Surf N Turf. But before the second Battletoad, I'd had tag team partners, like, I was going through them like hot dinners. Like, I had one every, a different tag partner every show I had. So I had, like, just trying to find someone that would fit. And then we sort of gelled and we stayed together for quite a while. And then we split. And then
so, how do you feel about Surf N Turf as a whole?
Oh, I loved it. Yeah. It's, you know, the name, it's sort of the comedy. So, because I'm more of a comedy wrestler, obviously, you've got guys out there but that like the more serious side of it and stuff. And I do love the serious side of stuff and that as well, the sporty side. And look, to be honest, when I was in the army watching wrestling and that, I used to think, oh, these gimmicks and stuff, they make a mockery of the wrestling and stuff. Until I actually did it myself, I realized how important having comedy and stuff in those shows is. And one of my biggest fans is probably my mother, which I did not see coming.
No.
I thought that my dad, I think, was a title defense or something. My dad, nah, I'm going to go watch the Broncos and the Cowboys. My mum said, no, I'm going to watch.
Yeah.
I mean, not Combat Wombat. Who's?
I'll bleep it.
Yeah, good. Thanks. Yeah. And I think I said my last name in one of them too. So
you did. I bleep that too.
Yeah. So, but she was really, and she'd bring friends that I had people say, "Oh, wrestling's stupid." And now they're all wrestling fans.
Yeah.
And I think the Globe was a really, it was a time that really, I don't know, really pushed us in the
times. You and I went interstate twice, and the cool one about that first time is we technically won the medals, the tag straps.
Oh, that's right.
Then we went back again after we'd like freshly broken up. Then you went back. Then I got you another booking.
Yeah,
as a singles against Massive Q in the gold medal match. Which is the
massive kick. Yeah, that one sucked. Yeah, I got
slammed. A lot of choke slams.
Choke slams 8 times in a row, I think.
Good match. Just poor guy got murdered.
Yeah. It was a nice flight home anyway. It was pretty good.
All I remember is you'd be on a plane and asleep.
Mate, yeah. Oh, yeah, I could sleep anywhere.
And then we always got stuck in one bed.
Oh, yeah, in Sydney we did. Oh, yeah.
And all mate Chan. Chainsaw.
Couldn't do that in the 90s either.
Did call all sorts of things.
But yeah, so as you said, what, you're going to get a 47?
Oh, no, don't put words in my mouth. We'll see how we go. I mean, I always need stuff to keep going. And like, I went through a lot of stuff, as you know, and with the PTSD and stuff. And it took a hold of me a bit. And I was going to give it all up. But then last year, I think with Wide Bay, I thought I'll keep going a bit. Nightfall and...
You got EWA as well.
Yeah, I think a few guys have sort of... I'll stick around Brisbane. I probably won't do much out of state anymore, but we'll see. But can anyway. We can't really do much at the moment.
No. Look, I'm sure at some point I'll throw the hood back on. We'll have a proper reunion.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, I'm not sure about you. But I have people talking to me about it all the time.
Yeah.
Like, oh, Surf N Turf this, Surf N Turf that. Like, oh, you know, you should
do it again. It was a lot of fun. I mean, the promos were... we did a lot of them, didn't we? And
we did one for every show.
Sorry?
We did one for every show.
Yeah, we did, yeah.
And they always got, like, the most views.
Yeah.
Which is crazy. And then
and even a lot
I remember,
of my sisters loved watching them. Play them for the nerf views and stuff, yeah.
And I remember I put one together for you and Seeker. A two-part series.
Oh, yeah, that wasn't that far ago. That was last year, wasn't it?
Yeah. And I think the funny thing was, once we stopped doing those style promos, there wasn't anything like it anymore. So I think when we finally put it together, and I'm like, let's do a Surf N Turf style promo.
Yep, yeah.
They're like, oh, okay. And you're like, yeah, sweet. Seeker's like, yeah, Seek.
Yeah.
And then we put that together. And oh, man.
And that was when I was running around the gym with Tim Tams, wasn't I?
Running around the gym, yeah.
Yeah.
And then having beers at the back of yours.
Oh, yeah, yeah. But at the actual gym with the Tim Tams, it was actually, I don't know if it was BoxFit or something, some girls training, and I ran past and I started waving them in front of them. The instructor was not impressed with me at all.
Yeah. Yeah, look, I've got thoughts of it, and I think I've got a way to make it happen too, in my head, where it'll be like, I'm reluctant to do it, but when I do it, it's like, okay, we're here, let's do it.
Yeah.
Because I think, that should stir it up a little bit, you know, see how we go. Start losing this weight again. No, 96 now. Doing all right.
Oh, that's, yep. Yeah, wait. Well, your age is, you'll be all right. But once you get older, it gets a lot harder.
Mm.
Which I've realized. And like I said, when I went to Timor, I was 80 kilos and 65 when I come back, and it was quite easy to do that. But we didn't eat a lot. We only ate one meal a day. So
yeah, right.
Mainly because the weight and stuff in your pack, you didn't want to put too much food in there.
Mm.
So you sort of just cut it out as much as you could. And plus, the rat packs taste like shit anyway, so...
Well, why? Because the rats got to them?
Tabasco.
No, because the rats got to them?
Oh, well, that did happen too, but they were shit before then. And I remember one section, I don't know where they got it, but they always got lots of different food sent over, and I even had loaves of bread, so I don't know where the hell they got all this. And, you know, you see guys march past on their backpacks, and they've got, like, their, you know, water bottles hanging off them, and... a pouch for extra ammo or whatever, but no, these guys had a fry pan hanging off the back of theirs. I don't know where they got the food from, and they always had, they had a Jaffa lion as well. I don't know where all this stuff come from.
Actually, speaking of army gear, we also wear the army gear out for our matches.
Yeah, that was the old chess rigs that I used to
have. So I wore...
You actually wore one that I actually wore the second trip.
Mm.
And
I
actually bought one when I become a medic. I bought one from Platypus down in, which is a big company that makes military gear. But when I got to my new unit, a rule came out that we weren't allowed to use those anymore because they want us to use the army gear because apparently it's better. Which, so your own stuff, they wouldn't let us.
And that helmet you wore, was that over there as well?
Not the one I wore, no.
No?
No. So I wanted that one, good quality one, for when I was a medic.
Yeah.
Because it had a lot more pouches and stuff, and I thought, oh, that might be quite handy, but it came out that we weren't allowed to...
Bird got out of a case.
Yeah. we weren't allowed to use it.
Hello, Nugget.
Yeah. We weren't allowed to use those anymore, so I actually wore it more in wrestling than I actually did.
Yeah.
And
we had a look good time.
I used to have a good mate. He ended up being a sniper in commandos, but he used to make packs and gear like that from scratch.
Yeah, right. Crazy. Yeah,
and he'd stay up all night and make it. I think he used to charge $300 and back in those days.
That's not bad.
Yeah, but I'm not sure what they'd be worth now. What I don't know. But the army come in with these rules that you had to have the gear that they supplied. I guess it was so they could... know the quality. I don't know why. They just wanted everyone to look the same, which is that the army is sort of, you've got to all sort of look the same a bit. So
yeah, I guess that's part of it, eh?
And having guys all mix and match and stuff, it sort of doesn't look professional. So
So yeah, what's your one takeaway from wrestling as a whole?
Jeez. Well, it's just enjoying it and having fun, I think.
You're not taking yourself too seriously?
Well, yeah, I guess to have fun and stuff. I mean, you've got to be serious so no one gets hurt and stuff like that. You know, you've got to take it just seriously, but also see the funny side of it as well. And things don't always go to plan. And I think I learnt that early on in the army, that things just go to shit all the time. There was an old saying that the world is a shit sandwich, and sometimes you just got to man up and take a bite. And I think sometimes wrestling just doesn't go to plan. Things go wrong, whatever, but we always seem to get through it. Things always seem to get there in the end, you know?
Yeah.
I've sort of got a saying where I say, we learn from the past, live in the present to work for the future. And wrestling to me wasn't really making money. I was never in it to be in the WWE, which I think most people do wrestling. They want to go up the ranks and get into the higher leagues, like in, you know, in Japan, the States, and even UK and Europe.
Yeah. But
myself, I was happy with Brisbane. And I ended up going interstate, which I didn't plan to do. That just sort of happened. And yeah, look, I think people got a bit of a... They realised when I said, look, I'm more into this for the fun side of it and that. But when they saw how much effort I was putting in, because in 2012, my build-up, I was training, like, actual wrestling training 3 days a week. And then I was doing gym and that as well. I figure I don't know what the hell was wrong, why I was doing a lot of that training. And I was, I'd sort of train on, I think, Tuesday, Thursday, and then I'd drive to Ipswich on Saturday from Alderley and train. And it's funny, I used to live in Alderley. We'd come and have matches out at Braid Park. And then I would move out to Braid Park. We ended up having matches in the city. It's just like... Oh. What couldn't have been the other way around? But
actually, a funny story. I think it was the second time we went there. That kid in the Hulk mask.
Oh, down at...
Go.
Go, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So there was this kid who just fell in love with us pretty much straight away. And it was his birthday or something? Or it was just like...
His dad took his wrestling for the... I think that was the first time for... I'm not sure, but he had the Hulk outfit on. And the second time I went, he was there, and his dad told me...
it was a Halloween show or something.
How he actually found out that I was coming down again. And he said for 2 weeks, he was excited every day.
That's right. Yeah, yeah, because he was there the first time, and they found out that we were coming down again.
Yeah.
And yeah, the response was much bigger that time. We got a big pop.
That was against the prefix, wasn't it?
That was against prefix, yeah.
A massive queue when I wrestled, because we did single ones.
After.
Oh, actually, we might have split up by then, weren't we?
We split up. Yeah, yeah. Because I faced... Fuck, who did I face?
You in the... Were you in the main for that? I can't even...
I'm trying to remember which show it was.
Yeah.
If it was the show I think it was, it was Minsaw Bay.
Yeah.
But I think it was a different show.
It was
show.
A really small arena, like a small hall too, wasn't it?
Well, yeah.
The ring hardly even fitted in there.
Yeah. Now, the thing it might have been, me and Saw Bay, might have been a different one.
If you got thrown out of the ring, you'd never end up outside. Like, it was so close to the... Remember that? Yeah.
But yeah, no. Yeah, it was a good show. Yeah. But yeah, no, that... So then the kid was there, and we ended up giving him a shirt.
Crying. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Yeah. And you do get... kids that get emotional and that. And I remember one when I got a letter from a little girl, and I still got it at home. I was just amazed that she went so much effort to send me a letter, which also impressed me too, because these days no one writes letters. But
no, look, I think that's one reason why I love Dolphin so much, is just because the kids.
Yeah, but sad thing was, we did a lot of adult shows when we were Surf N Turf.
But even the adults loved us. The adults loved us.
Yeah, especially drunk adults, yeah.
Oh, all the time. Yeah. I remember when we came out for the homecoming show. We're like running in the crowd. And they were like, this is like a mosh pit. As soon as they saw we were running in the crowd, everyone went to us.
Yeah, that's right.
It was like
this
big mosh pit.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Like, it just shows how everywhere.
Yeah, that were a good show. They were really good shows, though, those homecoming ones. You did a really good job with those.
Yeah, that was good fun.
That was in, the RSL. Was that Kedron?
It was in Kedron Wavell.
Yeah, Wavell did a really good... They do a good job with anything, though. I've been to concerts and stuff. They do pretty good.
PWL's still going there.
Oh, right.
That's where they're running out of that big room.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, so that's good. But yeah. So what was your one takeaway from the army? If you got like one quote from the army, what is it?
Well, probably with that one I said before about you learn from your past, you live in the present to work for the future, because you sort of, the army taught me that we all make mistakes, and I found that when I was in the army, it didn't matter what color skin you were, how good you were, how good looking, how ugly, how fat, how skinny. In the army, everyone's a piece of shit. And you work together to make things better. And you learn from your... Everyone, I think everyone stuffs up. I mean, a few times there, I've dug a few shit pits. I got into trouble and I've been punched a couple of times. That obviously, you can't do it these days. But I've had a couple of corporals give me a good whack. Lovely. And guess what? I never did that mistake again.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Sometimes we sort of... Oh, hitting's wrong. Yeah, probably right, but I must admit we sort of never made that mistake again. But
yeah,
it,
was,
it could be pretty tough. And like the guys in the 80s, I mean, they had it a lot harder than us. I think they used to polish the floors, then put socks on their hands and do push-ups, and every time they'd slip and smash their face against the... I mean, they used to do some really tough stuff. And we were sort of at the end of that hardcore stuff. I mean... Like after Vietnam and that, they got really tough on all that sort of punishment and stuff like that. And it's sort of when I got in, I was a reserve from end of 96 after I left school. Then in 99, I was in the regs. See, even in the reserves, I copped it. I mean, I got was laying down, I was firing a weapon, and I got a kick between the legs and told to shape up. I got a couple of whacks. Yeah, even in the reserves, and reserves had a bit of a... I were called chocos, and we melt in the sun and stuff like that. And I think one guy used to call us SAS. We worked Saturday and Sunday. And we had these sort of things, sort of people sort of looked down on us a bit that were in the regs. And I used to think, oh, we're the same. I don't know why they like that. And then when I joined the regs, I went, oh, my God, this is so different.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it was really hard to start with. But, yeah, definitely, I think that's where I say you learn from your past. And even with depression and looking at it, I've learned a lot from it. And if I didn't have depression, Combat Wombat probably wouldn't be a thing. Because he actually helped a lot with my depression and get me through all
that. Because you're a different person.
Well, you are, yeah. Yeah, yeah. And you're sort of the same, but you're just hyped up. To a higher, and I'm a lot more confident and a lot more out there. And you learn. I used a lot of the military stuff, obviously not the sort of tactic and stuff, but the mindset to make yourself. And I used to bang my chest and that, and hype myself up before I'd have a match. And I used to do that when I was in the carriers and stuff, when I was in Timor. I had to try and hype myself up because you did, like I said, you didn't know what was going to happen and how things were going to go.
Yeah.
And I think it makes you really resilient. And, like, if I fail things, I don't get that upset anymore because I've failed a fair bit and shit happens. And when you do something right and you have a win, it's really a really great moment to sort of celebrate. So you find people that win all the time and never had a fail or... down on their luck, when it does happen, it's a disaster. Like, it is really bad, where people that have failed so much, and when they have a win, it's actually... Failing doesn't worry them anymore. And I think I got to that point. And sort of coming into wrestling and stuff, I don't know if I would have done it if I didn't join the army. Yeah. And same with the reenacting. I had a lot of... Growing up at school... You know, fearful of trying new sports or doing new things. Oh, people would think I'm an idiot. I love Star Wars figures and stuff like that and G.I. Joe comics, but I didn't buy them at school because I was scared of what kids thought of me. They all thought I was a loser anyway, but for some reason, I would think that they think I was even more of a loser. But now, I don't care what they think of me because, quite honestly, I don't care about them. So, I collect. I'm in my 40s and I've got more Lego than I've ever had. Yeah, and Star Wars figures, I mean, it's getting a little bit ridiculous. I think, you know, Hasbro and Star Wars Disney's got to stop making so many Star Wars movies because I'm getting too many characters and it's got nowhere to put them. And the Lego and stuff like that. And my girlfriend, she loves Harry Potter stuff. And so, because she sort of said to me, she didn't collect anything like that. She told me how much she loves this stuff and she'd love to be able to collect the Lego and the stuff. But she's in her 30s. I said, just do it. Who cares? If people don't like it because of that, well, that's their fault. That's not your fault.
Yeah. All right, you want that? Well, we're at 2.5.
Oh, wow.
Sadly, we're on a time limit.
Yeah, I could probably go for another 2.5 hours, but...
Oh, look, we can continue with gaming and all sorts of stuff. So I think that's just more proof that we should tee up another one sometime.
And that's the other thing. I'm in my 40s and I love playing video games and stuff. And like the other day, I got on there Red Dead Redemption online and my little nephew jumped on.
I'm playing the PC now.
Oh, you got that on the PC?
Yeah, it's good too.
Yeah.
Before we go down there, Wombat doesn't run his own socials. So I do. So for Wombat socials, you got Combat Wombat Pro Wrestler on Facebook, and then I think it's the Combat Wombat PW on Instagram. I think you'll find him like that anyway.
Yeah.
But yeah, thank you very much, Wombat. No worries. It was a great chat.
Thanks for having me.
Oh, good. All right. Well, we'll see you on the next one.
Yep. No worries. Hoorah. See you next time.